Grace and peace in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth to the elect across the earth. We love y'all so much. Welcome back to the dinner table. Very excited about this message. This message right here was actually birthed out of persecution. And that is why, even though it's not easy to do a lot of times, but you have to rejoice through your persecution, your tribulation, your long suffering, because there's a birthing process of some form of a blessing every single time. I kid you not. It's amazing. So welcome back to the dinner table. Of course, I'll be your server to serve you the amazing meal cooked by Jesus Christ, the King of the Kitchen. And if you're new to the channel, you're probably like, what did I just click on? He talking about dinner table and Jesus in the kitchen? Let me explain something to you. He has many titles. You see, Jesus Christ is not just the Lord of Lords. He is not just the King of Kings. He's the chef of all chefs. Can I get an amen? He's the King of the Kitchen. Now you see, now you know, right? The Bible says, I stand at the door and knock. Jesus now. He says, if you will let me in, I will have dinner with you. Could you imagine that? Imagine going out to a beautiful dinner with Jesus Christ. What kind of questions would you ask him? Come on, let's keep it real. I mean, you mess around and like, you ever been trying to get something done, and when the actual time comes to get the thing done, your whole brain like shuts down, you forget everything. I'll be at a dinner table like, I don't even know what to ask you right now, Lord. Like, I got so many questions. But it's time to eat, amen. And I'm honored to be your server. I'm going to give you this meal. And we're going to really simplify this and just call it Baptized in the Holy Ghost and Fire. More than likely will be the title. And what I meant by when I said this message was birthed out of persecution. Very, very sad, you know, but there was a man recently who he took a part of a clip out of the Mystery Tabernacle message. That's such a phenomenal revelation that you would think that anybody that would watch that sermon would be so touched by God that they would have too much of the fear of God to do such a foolish and damnable thing. But this man literally took the small clip when I described my testimony. This is my testimony. You understand? When the Lord Jesus Christ baptized and filled me with the Holy Ghost and fire, I've never changed my testimony. I've explained this over and over again, exactly how it happened. And he took that and he made a mockery of it. When I was explaining the wind, he had a worldly movie clips of like wind blowing tables around to provoke people to mock and laugh a holy testimony. Just, that's very, very, very dangerous. It ain't about me. I mean, mocking me, he could have did a video on the size of my head. You know what I'm saying? He could have did a video and put a watermelon on my neck, and I would have got over that. I can't comprehend why this man, out of everything, would make a mockery video of my testimony of being filled with the Holy Ghost and fire. Saints, let's just pray, because I feel that flow. You know what I mean? This is such an important message. I'm very excited for this meal. 2 Peter 3, just real quick. 2 Peter 3, verse 3. Knowing this first, there shall come in the last days scoffers walking after their own lusts. You see that? Having not the truth of God in them, right? In another place it says, you could also read Jude chapter 1, around like, you know, read verse 18 moving forward. But the mocking spirit is only going to get worse and worse. And my main concern, and again, I still got to edit the mystery of the ark, life-changing message. And a shout out to all our brothers and sisters that were at the conference. We miss y'all, man. And we really hope to get another conference, hopefully, Lord willing, soon. But I still got to edit the mystery of the ark. I still got to finish up the right hand of God. But this message right here, it had to cut that in line because of the severity of how bad that video is. And sadly enough, people in his YouTube channel, a lot of them were falling right into the trap, mocking, laughing, telling them how funny it is. And saints, I'm telling you, even if you have a personal problem with somebody, anything to do with the holiness of God, anything to do with the Holy Ghost, leave it alone. Don't mess with it. You see people mocking. Listen, even tongues, right? We know tongues is real, but we also know there are many that are not speaking a real tongue, right? But do not volunteer to be the tongue inspector that will point at people and say, oh, that's a demonic tongue. That's a demonic tongue. Oh, she's speaking an evil tongue. Because even if you were right 999 times, imagine that time you were wrong. And you pointed at somebody and literally said their tongues were evil when it was the Holy Spirit giving them utterance. As much as I want to do walkaways today, I don't want to do the walkaways today because I'm bound down. I'm like, this is too serious. This is too severe of a topic. But just let that sink in. Let it sink in. Think about what I'm saying to you. That one time a Christian points at a man or a woman and says, those tongues are of the devil. Because the Bible says they will speak in tongues as the Spirit gives them utterance. That's very, very dangerous. In 1 Samuel chapter 1, I want to show you something. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Lord. Chapter 1, okay? I want you to see this now. It's a very mature message. Okay, and it's very important, all right? So please don't get distracted. Stay focused. We're going to pray in a minute. 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 13. Now Hannah, she spoke in her heart, only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore Eli thought she had been drunk. And Eli said unto her, how long will you be drunken? Put away thy wine from thee. And Hannah answered and said, no, my lord, I am a woman of sorrowful spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but have poured out my soul before the Lord. Wow. Count not thy handmaiden for a daughter of Belial. For out of the abundance of my complaint and grief have I spoken hitherto. Wow. And if you continue to read here, she would eventually give birth, God heard her prayer, to a prophet who would bring judgment to the very same man that did not understand the holiness of a position this woman was in. Her intimacy was what you could say either mocked or not understood, and he tried to rebuke her. And I want you to let that sink in, that this man was in a very honorable position. Let's say maybe a pastor or a YouTuber that has a following or anything like that. I'm trying to compare it for you to see why this message is probably one of the greatest messages that Christ has ever given me. he, let's just say, mocked her and rebuked her. But she was sincerely crying out to God. She was utterly emptied out, crying that God would hear her prayer. And he was wrong. You see, he made a mistake. His judgment was wrong. And later on in life, that child that came from her matrix, her womb, matrix simply means womb, okay? Don't try to, this is exactly what I mean, that people expect me to lower my standard of talking and use simplified words because their minds are so corrupted that if they hear the word matrix, they now will think I'm some kind of Illuminati member from a matrix. The word matrix is actually in the Bible, okay? The womb, right? Let's just say it for what it is. That prophet that would come out of her womb would judge him. This is amazing. I couldn't help but to think of the book of Acts. Could you? Notice that he thought she was drunk with wine. Notice that when they were filled with the Holy Ghost and fire, they shouted, "These men are drunk." You see the parallel. I think it's safe to say we need to pray. I know you're very excited. You must be excited because it's been a little bit since we've had another dinner table message. Let's go ahead and pray. Lord Jesus Christ, we love you and we thank you for your mercy and your grace and your kindness. And thank you for growing in us and maturing us. Forgive us of all sins and wash us in your holy blood. We forgive our enemies. We ask you to fill us and give us the same mind that was in Christ Jesus. And we ask you to guide and direct us in this beautiful Bible study at the dinner table. Lord, destroy every power of darkness that could try to hinder your word and your presence and your blessings from touching us. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. So, mockers in the last days, scoffers, right? But sometimes it could be a sincere Christian who will actually misjudge something and have to pay the price for it, depending on what it is they're misjudging. That's why you have to be very, very careful. You know, you get what I mean. Like, a good example would be John the Baptist. I mean, who could compare themselves to John the Baptist? Wow. Anointed from the womb. He met God in his mother's belly. Like, what? You know what I'm saying? You could not separate him and Jesus, could you? It's amazing. He lived in the wilderness eating locusts and wild honey. His clothing was that of the prophet Elijah. Rugged, you know what I'm saying? He wasn't no pretty boy. That's why he said, "What have you come to see? A reed shaking in the wind? Some frail, effeminate man? Not happening. Or a king in soft raiment? Not happening." John the Baptist was a man of God, of authority, a prophet of the Most High God. He probably had a rugged beard, you know, probably had like hair grown out and he just looked all rough. Talking to you and grab a locust off a branch of a tree and eat it in front of you. You like, man, get this dude away from me. Not knowing this is the greatest prophet ever to live. I could almost guarantee he probably didn't smell the best either. You know, let's be honest. You know what I'm saying? He's living in the woods. I'm not saying he didn't clean himself. But how would you pass judgment on someone like John the Baptist? Be honest. If John the Baptist came up to you and said, "I have a message from the Lord," and another man in a suit and a nice fresh haircut and cologne on, and he hopped out of a BMW and said, "I have a message at my church from the Lord," who would you discern to go with? Would you automatically judge by appearance and go with the man in his expensive car back to his nice building and overlook the prophet of the Most High God because of his raiment, because of his clothing? Remember, James talked about don't be a judger of evil things, evil thoughts. So the reason I'm saying all of that is that I'm more strengthened now to be able to talk about this, but I don't really hold back at this dinner table, and I'm sure y'all know that by now, especially if you've been a part of the ministry for a good amount of time. We've probably cried together, let's be real, you know what I mean? I'm sure you have wept as I've wept at times because the presence of God is so overwhelming, and when you get overwhelmed by the love of God and the presence of the Lord, it's the most beautiful, beautiful experience, isn't it? So the night I seen that video. I'm going to tell you something for real, for real. I did weep. You know what I'm saying? I went in the prayer closet and cried out to God. Nothing else was moving me. When the man did one, two, three, I think, yeah, four slanderous live streams, whether fully about, you know, or just mentioning me in the live stream. And then he did a music video against me. None of those were moving me to react. Do you get what I mean? Like, I was just waiting on the Lord. I'm like, Lord, because in my mind, I'm like, where is this coming from? I knew there would be a tale of Satan. That's why, if y'all remember, I released that message before the conference, because when you gather together with hundreds of people, especially at a time when people are fearful, you got to realize the windows of heaven that opened up. You have to realize that. And a lot of y'all that came to that conference, there are changes going on the inside of you. And for y'all that weren't able to make it, don't be discouraged. You know what I'm saying? But the reality is there had to be some kind of retaliation attack. So even though it was a nuisance, in my mind, I'm like, Lord, I got messages to preach. You know what I mean? Like, ministry work to do. How do I deal with this man lying about me? What do I do? You know what I mean? But that video was different, though, because that was an attack on the Holy Ghost. So I took it differently. Let me tell you something. When you get to a place in your life where you're more hurt or offended when somebody disrespects the God you serve more than if they disrespect you, that is a beautiful place to be. It's a beautiful place to be. I remember there were certain times, like, for example, Moses. You know, when God was like, Moses, I'm wiping them all out. I'll start with you. And Moses said, but they're going to say, you're the God who took them out of Egypt just to slaughter them. He was so concerned with God's reputation. Wow. You can feel the grace of God, right? Like, just such a presence of the Lord in this message. Like, isn't that amazing? Doesn't that make you love Moses even more? One day, Lord willing, we're going to meet him. You know what I mean? By the grace of God. But think about that. He was so concerned with God's image being represented right. Wow. So, we had a lot of y'all reaching out that were troubled in your spirit from that video. And you wanted me to break it down so that way you can tell other people that might have seen the video that mocked it. So I'm actually very excited to do this. So let's go right in and start, shall we? So in my testimony, I'll say it again. You know what I mean? I'm not going to give the half asleep leg joke again, but that does happen when you pray long enough, your leg will fall asleep. But the day I was baptized and filled with the Holy Ghost and fire, I was pursuing God so much. That's what you gotta know. Like, the bigger testimony, testifying to how long I was seeking the face of God, abstaining from sin. I was literally knocking on his door every single day. You know, there's a story that Christ gives that a lot of people overlook. I hope you're enjoying this time of us just talking. Don't have that mind frame of, come on, man, get to the message. We've been in the message now for at least 20 minutes. Just because I haven't started and gone into the scriptures, we are living epistles. So just chill. Let's enjoy this time together. If it's, you know, we're not on the road eating fast food. We're at a dinner table. So let's enjoy this time. Amen. But pursuing God, right, and seeking his face and saying, Lord, I'm not going to let you go until you bless me. And I want to give the bigger explanation. I want to give the bigger testimony of how long I pursued God. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to explain it again to some of y'all that never heard it before. And this time, I'm going to break down step by step certain things about the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire that probably you have questions on. And hopefully, you'll be able to get through the whole message and be blessed and edified, and that your life will never be the same. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. So, I was seeking God, seeking him, seeking his face. I wouldn't let him go. And there's a nugget. There's a story in the Bible that Jesus talks about that a lot of people overlook. And it's the woman, I believe she was a widow, who bothered the king every single day. And she became a nuisance. Like, the king literally answered her request. Well, I would call it a prayer, but because you get what Jesus is saying, that we're supposed to be that woman bothering, knocking on the door of heaven. He was basically saying that she almost drove him up a wall. You know that figure of speech? Like, drove me up a wall. The king basically said, if I don't help this old lady and do what she's asking me, she gonna drive me crazy up in here. And he literally answered her request. Jesus was trying to give you and I a hint. He was trying to give us some secret advice, hopefully, that we would catch on to. You are supposed to pound on God's door until he opens up and fills you with the Holy Ghost and fire. And most believers that I come across are not seeking for the Holy Ghost baptism of the baptism. Most Christians that I know, or most Christians that I meet, are not seeking to get filled with the Holy Ghost and fire, the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire. They'll pray, they'll worship, you know what I mean? They're followers of Christ, but they actually do not pursue God and pound on the door of heaven in the name of Jesus Christ until he opens up and says, fine, I will fill you with my Holy Spirit and fire. Isn't that amazing? So I wouldn't let him go. I would not stop bothering him, y'all. I'm telling you, there was one time the enemy hit me with a really bad, like it was like a flu. You know what I'm saying? You know, when your whole throat's messed up, you got snots continually running. Hey, look, I know we at the dinner table and we eating. You know, I shouldn't be talking about boogers at the dinner table, but I got to be honest with you. I was utterly sick. I think I had like $25 to my name. This is before I met my amazing wife. Shout out to Lioness. We all love you. And I took a cab. You know what I'm saying? I had to go to service. I wanted to be around other believers so I could, because I knew the mystery that where two or more are gathered. I knew. I was like, I need this. And I kept going. I kept going. And I'll never forget crying out to God and just asking him, fill me with the Holy Ghost, Lord. Please, Jesus, fill me with the Holy Ghost and fire. Wow, it's like bringing back memories. And I had like a pile of like, you know, dirty tissues. I had a box of tissues. And let me tell you something. One day it happened towards the evening. It was wintertime. I forgot the month, but man, we were a group of brothers at a night, like an evening service. Like, it was kind of like ending the day, kind of. And we were just worshiping, crying out to the Lord. And they were like, all right, we need to wrap it up. You know what I mean? It's time to go home. And a voice literally said to me, get back down and worship me. And I'm like, what would you do? You know what I'm saying? You hear a voice tell you to get back down and worship me. And all of a sudden, I literally just started to say, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. And then all of a sudden, it would be like if a tornado was forming over you. You ever see like a YouTube video of like a tornado where the guy's looking up and the funnel is right above his house? That's got to be a crazy sight to see. It was almost like this swishing sound, right? And I could feel this turning. And what most of you would call a door opened up over me. Some of you might call it a gateway. I use the word portal, but they're all the same thing. You understand? Now, I'll break that down after because I don't want to stop the testimony, because that was one of the things that he was mocking me with. But this window, this portal, this gateway that opened up over me as I was down on my face like this. And I'm hearing this wind, but it wasn't rushing. It wasn't like it was like a slow turning. And then all of a sudden, wham, right into my back, this wind. It was like if I was in a tornado funnel, I kid you not. And this fire started filling through my back, all in my belly. All in my belly, all in my chest, my shoulders, I couldn't even move. You know, like you go to like a Sunday building and you see the same people just, you know what I mean? Just acting and you know it, but of course, be careful. But my experience, I couldn't move like that. Even if I wanted to. My hands, I was digging into the rug. It was so overwhelming, the power, the fire, the Holy Ghost. Jesus Christ, the high priest, literally baptized and filled me with the Holy Ghost and fire that day, that evening. It felt like it lasted an hour. The most amazing feeling I've ever experienced in my life. It is supernatural. My brothers and sisters, I wanted to show you this quick video. This video literally brought tears to my eyes when I first found it, because it's very rare to hear other people give a testimony like mine. Other than one other man that we actually know, we've never heard anyone else give the same testimony that I gave. But when we found this video, I literally wept. And I want you to watch it, and I want you to compare how they testify to the baptism of the Holy Ghost in fire to mine. And although these children of the devil want to mock my testimony, I want you to be honest, sincere. What does the Word of God say? These people that don't even know God will try to tell you, oh, the Holy Spirit is gentle and He'll just slowly enter into your spirit. Jesus Christ wasn't given the Holy Spirit without measure. That means He was always filled with the Holy Ghost and fire. But if you notice in the book of Acts, it was a mighty rushing wind. Do you understand? The power of God would have filled in them in such a powerful way. Jeremiah said, it's like a fire shut up in my bones. And saints, be honest. Judge these people righteously. Do they look like people that are just trying to lie to get a YouTube channel going? This is a small church congregation in the middle of nowhere who sincerely love the Lord It started to cry out, and the Lord Jesus Christ heard their cry. Listen to this video, and you decide if it sounds just like mine. Love you so much. Here it is.
Hungry for God and troubled by new reports of community drug use, they decided to add a special Sunday afternoon youth service. Among those leading the meeting were Pastor Moses Kayak and his ministerial colleagues Joshua and James Ariak, all great-grandsons of the original lightkeeper, Onguetizawak.
An invitation was offered for youth who felt they wanted to come closer to God.
Worship leader Louis Ariak was praying over the youth that had gathered around the altar.
I felt so close to God, and he kept giving me this verse that says, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God."
Something started to happen that was out of our control.
This noise started coming.
Yeah, it started softly, like you can barely hear it.
A dual cassette deck used to record the service was still running off the soundboard.
Right away, I wanted to stop,
but it kept getting louder, and I started to notice that people were kind of getting a little nervous.
It was so strong, so strong.
It was so loud that everything started to shake.
Fire went right through me.
It sounded like a jet.
Things started to shake. I started to shake.
I told myself, there's no jets in Pond Inlet.
After this extraordinary visitation, it was evident the moment still had power.
Every time I thought about it, I was greatly humbled. Thinking that the Almighty God can visit us.
When Pastor Moses Kayak first heard the low-pitched rumbling, he walked over to the church soundboard to adjust the settings.
I tried this, not stop, tried this, no stop.
When these efforts failed to correct the situation, he quickly turned down the master control. When this too failed, he shut the system off completely. Still, the sound and the recording continued.
It shouldn't have been recorded. It's only by the miracle of God.
Came into the town.
He was completely humbled to the point where he wanted to continually come before God, kneel, and ask for prayer, and ask for the cleansing of the heart, to become pure before Him.
The Word of God says in 2 Corinthians 13:1, "This is the third time I am coming to you. In the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established. I hope that now you will believe my report. I speak the truth in Christ and lie not. My baptism was a very mighty rushing wind and a power from heaven that went through my back and filled into my stomach, filled into my entire body. I couldn't even move." Saints of God, honestly discern these people. Do they look like they're trying to lie? Did you see that in them? Remember, the Bible says to the pure, all things are pure. But to the wicked-minded people, the Bible says their mind is always wicked. They only think of unclean things. Maybe these people lack knowledge. But all through the book of Acts, people were being filled with the Holy Ghost and fire that were coming out of a pagan lifestyle. You think God is judgmental like these wicked Pharisees? He looks at the heart. He looks at your spirit. How hungry are you for Christ? I hope that my testimony, my wife's testimony, and these people's testimony will encourage you to sincerely seek for the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire. And that if you ever hear anybody ever mock any supernatural experience because they simply do not know God, so they mock what they don't know, rebuke them sharply. Saints of God, seek for the Holy Ghost. And when it was finished, when the baptism was finished, and I was filled, I had tears, but they were tears of amazement, like joy. Like, it's hard to explain because, you know, there's many different types of tears, you know, tears of sorrow, tears of laughter. This was just a tears of like, Lord, you actually heard me. You actually responded back to me. Like, what? And as I barely could make it up and I stood up, the guys in that room, they were like, what just happened? I could see it on their face. Wow. You got to bear with me because I'm reliving it in my mind. You know what I mean? Which is better for me because sometimes it's good for you to just sit back and meditate. Now, the word meditate is in the Bible, okay? You see, people, their minds are so corrupted that you say meditate, they'll be like, oh, he's new age. It's like, why are people's minds so cursed in his last days that claim to be Christians? Why is it automatically so many Christians want to gravitate to the dark or negative of assumption instead of going, well, you can meditate on the Lord or somebody can meditate in yoga. It's their choice. But as I meditate on this, it blesses me to remember what God does for us and what he did for me. To remember what God did for me. So when we left that building, it was quiet in that Ford Explorer. I remember it clear as day because it was winter time. And I sat in the back of the Ford Explorer to the right, the back right-hand side of the passenger, you know, the back seat. And we're just driving. And I said, take me to Green Hill, which is like a park. You know what I mean? It's a big hill. And there was no like, oh, come on, man, I got to go do this. Nah, it was like, all right, let's go. You know what I mean? I think there was a real like fear because they could tell like these, there was a few brothers, the ones I was driving with that I kind of grew up with for a long period of my life. Not my whole life, but you know what I'm saying? So they knew, like, works don't be faking. You know what I'm saying? So something happened to him. God visited him. And I'll never forget on Lincoln Street, he pulled over to talk to a group of brothers on the block. And this brother was, like, they walked up to the Ford Explorer. And I had the window down. You know what I mean? Just feeling that cold breeze and he put his hand on the window, like, you know, like leaned in on the window of the door. And it was like I couldn't even control. My hand just landed right on the top of his hand. And I said, I don't even remember because it was the Lord. Something was said to that brother. And it was about his own life. And when he looked at me in my eyes, it was like he knew. Because I'm not, you know what I'm saying? I didn't know him. And whatever, I don't even remember what the brother looked like. All I know is he was blessed that night. It was like prophesied over him. And we drove off. We were headed to Green Hill. And listen, I could feel movement in my belly. Not like your flesh. You have a spirit belly. The Bible says, out from your belly shall flow rivers of living water. Okay, so, but anyways, it felt like my real stomach though. I could feel movement in there, like moving around. I'm like, what is going on? Like, this is amazing, Lord. And I was so filled with joy that when we got to Green Hill, I just ran up that hill. Now at this time, it's completely night. The sky is wide open. It was beautiful. You could see the heavens. The heavens. And that's another thing. Galaxy, universe, heaven. Should you really condemn somebody to be of the devil because they don't have the knowledge you have of what universe means or galaxy? It's the heavens, right? But people are so corrupt in their brain. Anyways, so the heavens was wide open. And I'm looking at these stars and I'm just running. And I'm shouting for joy. I'm like, thank you, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, for filling me with the Holy Ghost and fire. And this burning was all over me, y'all. I'm telling you. The most amazing time of my life was that night. And that's the reason why, when that video was done, that right there really, really troubled my spirit. So, I want to break down where my testimony was mocked by this man, and sadly by, you know, his immature followers, because he's a foolish man. You know, Paul said, you foolish Galatians, who have bewitched you? He's a foolish man for real. And those that went along and was laughing at his stupid video, they're foolish. And they lack understanding. The Bible says, comfort the weak. Let me just go to it. This is in Thessalonians. And it talks about, you know, support the weak and this feeble-minded people. And you have to be patient with all men. Look, in Jesus' name. Here it is. Now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly. You see that? And I'm warning any of you out there that you're quick to mock things, you're unruly, you better watch it. I'm telling you. It says, warn them that are unruly, comfort the feeble-minded, support the weak, and be patient towards all men. Ah, you see this? So, what I want to do is just break all this down. And you asking the Lord to give you discernment. If we go through the scriptures and we break it down very simplified, that you'll be able to see that that man made a big mistake. He really did. He really did. Listen, there was a time where Paul said, I speak the truth in Christ and lie not. Why do you think he had to say that? Because there were certain supernatural things done through him by Christ. And there were certain things that he would say to people that there would be people afterwards that go, this guy's a fake, he's lying, and try to turn people away from Christ and Paul. It's happening today. This still happens now. You have to know this. That's why you have to have a personal relationship with the real Jesus Christ. Remember, the real Jesus Christ. So, let's break down everything piece by piece. The first thing that was mocked in the video was the fact I used the word portal. Saints of God, I'm not going to change the education level that God has given me to suit foolish people who are dark-minded, who don't have understanding. I will humble myself. You know, Jesus humbled himself. And he would teach in parables to make things easy to understand. So, remember when I said it opened up over me a doorway or a gateway? I call it portal. And I want us to look up the word portal in the, you know, like a Webster's dictionary, okay? So, let's go ahead. I'm going to use my phone just real quick. Portal, Webster's Dictionary definition.
According to Merriam-Webster, definition of portal. 1. Door, entrance especially, a grand or imposing one. 2. The whole architectural composition surrounding and including the doorways and porches of a church.
You see that? So, a portal, right, is, it can be a doorway, a gateway, right? And let me see here. There's one even further down. Hold on. And I won't even use Webster's. I'll just say portal. Portal definition.
Here's the definition of portal. A doorway, gate, or other entrance, especially a large and imposing one.
Did you hear that? So portal simply means a doorway, a gate, or some kind of entrance. So just think about this logically now. Think about the foolish people that fell into that trap of watching that video. And because I used the word portal, he took worldly video clips of some super Marvel movie or something, portal of a guy falling through and ha ha ha. But see, when I'm talking about the Holy Ghost, you have to realize that God is not mocked. You will reap what you sow. Just know that. Know that. So now that you've heard it with your own ears, what portal means, I prefer the word portal because when I hear about doors in heaven, doors that opened up, gateways, do you honestly think it's like a door, like a wooden door with a doorknob and it's like, and like, you know, God comes out and blesses us? I see it. See, this is going to be for mature believers. And I'm be real with you. If you don't believe you're rooted and mature enough to be serious right now, probably just leave. You know what I'm saying? Because this is very holy conversation right here. This is very sacred. And I'm very, trust me, this is no joke. So that's my disclaimer. Okay, but if you're mature and you love the Lord and you fear God and you're willing to hear what I got to say, even if it's foreign to you, right? Because people fear the unknown and that makes them either fight it or mock it or hate it, right? That's why there's racism in certain things. You know, if there's a white person who never grew up around any other type of nationality, or if there's a Chinese or whatever, sometimes they're not right with that person because of fear of the unknown. It's an evil thing, right? But I'm going to show it to you now. I want you to imagine. It's a good way to put it. Okay, all right. I mean, this, I guess it's a decent example, right? I want you to imagine that. Let me write something down so you can see. Like I said, I'm trying to break this down the best I can, all right? I want you to imagine, now you see that, hopefully you can see that, it says Earth, right? I want you to imagine that on this side of the paper is Earth. On this side of the paper is Heaven, okay? So, when God does things, when he travels, right? If you study your word, you know that he sends his angels. He himself visits the earth. Remember, he visited Abraham. Remember when Abraham seen the three? I mean, this is such an amazing word. Remember Melchizedek? I mean, who do you think that was? Like, this is exciting. Remember when Jacob wrestled with God, right? But I want you to see this now. What happens is a portal or a doorway or a gateway, whatever word you prefer, that's fine with me. Just don't mock that I choose portal. I don't care about the new age sci-fi movies, CERN, Hadron Collider. If the word portal is used over there, it don't mean they get to keep that word. Do you get what I mean? That word belongs over here. You know what I'm saying? It's like the word meditation. Think about this logically, right? Yoga, new age, they're well known for the word meditate. But does that mean I should be afraid to say the word meditate because of feeble-minded Christians that'll get in the comment section and be like, well, Brother Wally is meditating like a yoga student? No, no, you just have the spirit of dumb and you need to be delivered. It's that simple, right, brothers and sisters? So let's say that God wants to visit. Okay, oh, perfect example. One of the scriptures we're about to read, and I'm very excited about this message, by the way. Genesis 28, you've heard of when Jacob fell asleep on the rock. Now, of course, the rock represents who? Jesus Christ. Can I get an amen? In other words, when you put your mind on the rock, when you rest on Christ, the window of heaven opens up. Come on now. Can I get an amen? So, in that moment, the windows of heaven, the gates of heaven opened up over Jacob. Okay, we're going to read it. It's very fascinating. Matter of fact, how about this? Before I show you this example, let's read. You better have your Bible. Girl, you better stop, brother. Come on now. We need this Bible. You got your word, you got your notebook, you got your pen. Because I know, even though this is a dinner table, it's a classroom. Amen. So, let's go there. It's Genesis chapter 38. Let's go. Hallelujah. Genesis chapter 38. Now, check it out. And it's important that, now don't let it puff you up, but it's important that you try to learn Hebrew and Greek, okay? A little bit. Just study a little bit each week to give you a greater, fill you with more wisdom and knowledge to have a deeper understanding of the scriptures, amen? So, in Genesis 28, look at what it says now, in Jesus' name. In verse 10 going down, it says, and Jacob went out from Beersheba and went towards Haran. Okay, and he lighted upon a certain place and he tarried there all night. Because the sun was set, he took the stones of that place and put them for his pillow. See, that represents Christ. And lay down in the last place to sleep. And lay down in that place to sleep. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth. And the top of it reached to where? Heaven. Wow. And behold, an angels of God ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it. You see that word above, right? And said, I am the Lord God of Abraham, thy father, the God of Isaac. Wow. The land wherein you liest, to thee will I give it and to thy seed. Now, think of how terrifying this is. This blessed man wakes up. He sees a portal. Or a gateway, or a door, or window, whatever you want to call it, it's the same thing. Let me just say this analogy. Let me get some water. Let me just say this analogy real quick so you have a better understanding. I drank that like a commercial. Come on, keep it real. You know what I'm saying? Held it out like, what up? Yo, Fiji expensive. I just got that because it was 2 for $4 at the gas station. You feel me? But picture like everybody staring at a car. You know, Paul, he calls it a vehicle. Sarah, she calls it a whip. Jerome calls it a car. You know what I'm saying? Whatever, Jimmy calls it a motor vehicle or something. You get what I'm saying? So in other words, they would call the car by different names, like titles, but it's still the same car, right? So if some of you call what I call a portal, you might call a window. Some of you might prefer to just call it a doorway, which is the normal one. Some of you might call it gateway, which is another one I love. But some of you might actually call it portal, like me.
Children to give him glory, but God has to pump us to give him glory. He has to break us to give him glory, because we won't do it when he show up. When he asks for it, we won't do it. So on the job, when you're on the job and all of a sudden he's saying, this is a good time to give me glory. because if you give me glory right here, glory will open up a portal here for other people to sense my presence. I'm trying to come through. I'm trying to pierce the veil of the natural. Glory will open up a portal here for other people to sense my presence. I'm trying to come through. I'm trying to pierce the veil of the natural.
You see what I'm saying, though? So he called it portal. When I seen that sermon, I wasn't like, what's he in the new age? See, my mind ain't corrupt. You know what I mean? Like, remember, one of the most important scriptures that you need to know about is that the Bible says, to the wicked and defiled, all things are unclean. That means anything they look at, it's like they see something bad. But to the righteous and to the pure, all things are pure. That means if you have a pure mind, remember the Bible says in Philippians, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are good, whatsoever things are right and just, think on these things. If you have a pure mind, you're not going to just see negative everywhere and evil and dark. You're going to naturally try to find the good in places, the good in people. If you happen to see something wrong, it won't be the same as somebody with a corrupt mind. All they see is darkness. Do you get what I mean? That's like you could be, you know, going to a church or something, and if somebody's attacked with that negative mind, let's say, sister, you got a pair of, like, you know, you got a nice outfit on, and your heels have a little butterfly at the bottom of the heel, right? Now, you're not educated on monarch mind control and Illuminati has butterfly symbolism. God made the butterfly, so why give that to the Illuminati, right? Think about what I'm saying. And imagine you go to a church service and they're corrupted in the mind. They watch Illuminati exposed videos all night. And here you are, you're like, praise the Lord. And they're like, oh, praise the Lord. But they look down and the women kind of whisper at each other like, is she Illuminati? And they start, like, you know, treating you weird. And you're like, what's going on here? Oh, well, it was your shoes because you had a butterfly on it. So it's you got to be very careful. So, again, portal, right? So the window of heaven was opened up in this place. And could you imagine, he's seeing angels ascending and descending. They're going whoop right up into that opening. Okay, there's another word you can use. They're going into the opening and they're coming down. They're going up, they're coming down, right? And I believe the ladder wouldn't be like, you see like a painter's ladder where it's just like this. I don't believe it's like that. I believe it was a turning ladder that would more represent DNA. I'm not going to get into that. But he looks up, and God Almighty, through this dimension, oh, this is, see what I mean? Isn't this fun? When you have a clean mind, you can actually have a great sermon and not be weird about something. Through this opening, this gateway, portal, this door, God the Father speaks to Jacob. I'm about to do the walk. I said I'm not going to try to do a walk away today, but I almost did a walk away right there. So this portal opened up, right? Well, let me ask you a question. Was that opening always there? Absolutely not, right? It wasn't like when Jacob got there, the window of heaven was already open. The gateway, the portal, the opening was already there. And he was like, oh, hey, God, I'm just going to take a nap. And then when I wake up, you can talk to me. Nah, it was a normal sky. Think about this. This is a very exciting message. And this was birthed out of the persecution that came against us. That video, that mockery, drew me into the prayer closet, drew me into prayer. And now God gave me this message to give to y'all. So what the enemy meant for evil, God has turned for good. So celebrate, because you're getting a great meal right now. Glory to Christ. So look at it this way. When he arrived in that place, right? Bethel, the house of God, right? There was a regular sky, you know what I mean? Clouds and whatever, right? When he woke up, there was an opening. Right? I don't know. I think breach might be a good word. There was an opening to another dimension. So this is where I wanted to show you this simple analogy. So picture he's looking up and the paper represents the sky, right? Earth, on one side, right? So he's looking up. The angle ain't the best because of the camera. But so here's Jacob. Picture the pen as Jacob. He's sleeping. He looks up. And something's different. Check it out. Watch this. I'm tearing this paper off. It was supposed to make a neat little line. Not me. Not Brother Wally. He looks up. Now, check it out. You see the opening? You see the opening, right? Angels are coming through, the dimension. And there's an opening. There's a door. There's a gateway that's been opened up as he's looking up. And angels are going up through that hole, that opening, that portal, that doorway, whatever you want to call it. And they're coming down. And the voice of God is speaking to Jacob through the breach of the dimension. That is amazing. So, gateways and portals and windows are all through the Bible. But again, people are so dumbed down that I don't know if they think like an actual window, you know, like wooden frame. You know, in Malachi where it says, come and, you know, try me and see if I won't open up the windows of heaven. Do they think like God actually, like a window glass with like, you know, the little curtain and the, and he's just like, he unclicks and he lifts it up. He's like, my child, can you hear me? You know what I'm saying? Like, or a doorway is some wooden door with a knob. And Jesus is like, hey, Gabriel, we're going to have to fix the hinges on this door. It's getting a little rusty. I'm about to come riding through on the horse. You know what I'm saying? Like, these are openings. But see, instead of my terrible rip, these openings, right? This is a very fun message. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Let's take a minute and just thank the Lord. Lord, thank you for this message. What an awesome message. We give you the glory in Jesus' name. Instead of it being a permanent opening, when God opens up a dimension to come through, right, whether angels or whatever, it closes up. You know what I'm saying? Like it literally, like you see, like someone gets cut and the wound heals and it closes back up. Now, we know that God is omnipresent, but how many of y'all know that there's different ways God will visit you? Just because he's omnipresent doesn't mean he's with you the same way everywhere. It don't work that way. Okay, for example, Jesus is God Almighty. Well, if God is omnipresent, what's the difference then when he literally showed up and visited Paul when he was Saul on the road to Damascus? Do you get it? So Jesus had to actually travel in his glorified body. Now, of course, with God, it doesn't have to be like, you know, flying through time and space, and he could just appear. But he, there's doors and these openings happen and he enters into this dimension. Okay, think about it like this, right? If you went to the ocean, it sounds good right now, don't it? Just laying on the beach, beautiful sunlight hitting, you know what I mean? Collecting that warmth from God. You know what I'm saying? He created the sun and the moon and the earth, right? So when you feel that warmth from the sun, it's a reminder of the warmth of the Holy Ghost when he's touching you, amen? Imagine just laying on a beach, the crashing of the waves. Some of y'all are like, come on, man of God, don't do it to me. Crashing of the waves, you hear the birds beefing for the leftover fried dough next to you. Water's nice and crisp, not too, I'm just messing with y'all. You can tell I want to go to the beach, but if you want to go into that ocean, keep it real, you got to pierce through the water. Like, look it, when I go to a beach or an ocean or whatever, I mean, Savannah's maybe 3 hours away, I'm not there to show off a six pack. Can I get an amen? I ain't got a six pack anyway, you know what I'm saying? But my wife and I, we actually want to have fun with our children. You know what I mean? Like, We'll get in the water with the goggles. And, you know, I'm still putting earplugs in like a 10-year-old. For real, don't make fun of me. You know what I'm saying? Put the earplugs in. But it's so fun when you jump into that water and you just swim in. Like, you know what I mean? Like, some of y'all might not get down like that. Some of you brothers just, you know, you want to play football in the sand. Nah, I'm there to be 10 years old. You feel what I'm saying? But my point is, I got to pierce through that water to enter into that next dimension, that water. You see what I'm saying? So God has to pierce through to get into this physical dimension. Because, you know, Paul tried to break it down in Corinthians. It wasn't so easy for him to do. He was talking about this celestial and terrestrial. One is this, and there's this type of flesh and this type of flesh, right? Think of how the angels come here. Think of like the angels of the Most High God that are sent down here. Some angels that visited Paul. Remember when he was on the ship? He said, "The angel of the Lord, whose I am and who I serve, have spoken to me." You know what I mean? Some people think it's hocus pocus that you can actually speak with angels. See, these dark-minded, satanic, corrupt-minded people. Remember what we said? Let's talk that scripture. I'm going to run that scripture all through this message. What did I say it was? To the dirty and defiled, everything is dirty. You understand? To the pure, everything is, they're not dirty. So when I talk about angels, this is something that shouldn't even be a weird topic. The only way an angel can communicate with me is through Jesus Christ. You see what I'm saying? So the angel visited Paul. How do you think the angel got to him? He had to have traveled, whether it's some type of way outside of time and space, but he definitely broke through somewhere, somehow, to enter our dimension. Are y'all following? So let's go ahead. This is very exciting. We're going to have to go through these scriptures. Now, okay. There's so many. Revelations. Let's go. I'm probably going to tell you to write some down. All right, let's go. Revelations chapter 4. This is a very interesting one. All right, you probably already beat me. Revelations 4 verse 1. Look at what it says. Look at what it says in Jesus' name. After this, I looked and behold, a door was opened in where? Heaven. And the first voice which I heard was as it were a trumpet talking with me, which said, "Come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter." So he looks up, and there's a door opening, and he hears a voice say, "Come up." How amazing is that? So supernaturally, he went up through that opening. I call it a portal. You could call it a door. Just don't think it's a wooden door. You know what I'm saying? Keep it real. Some of y'all thought that. Don't lie. Sister, don't be lying at the dinner table now. Give me your plate. You know what I'm saying? Brother, it's not a wooden door with a doorknob, man. It's an opening. You see what I'm saying? So that's why I choose the word portal, because to me, that's what it really more sounds like. You see what I'm saying? It's sort of like in the Bible, prophets would see things and they didn't understand it. So they didn't know how to describe it. Like when the Almighty baptized in the River Jordan, the man tried to describe it the best he can, the whole scenario, right? Window opened up. We're going to get into that. Amazing, by the way. But he described the Holy Spirit as like a dove descending in a bodily shape. Now, do you think the Holy Spirit, and again, there's probably some of y'all out there that actually think the Holy Spirit's some pure white bird. No, no. He couldn't describe the Holy Spirit. He's so beautiful, so gentle, so amazing. He said, the only thing I can really describe is like a dove, like pure and white and just shining and clean and gentle. And you know what I'm saying? So sometimes it's not easy to describe things. But you have false teachers online, effeminate men who will try to challenge what I'm saying.
although they've never experienced the filling of the Holy Ghost and fire, they'll say, well, the Holy Spirit is always just gentle. Was God gentle when he struck Ananias and Sapphira dead? Brother Work said it was like, wham, the Holy Spirit don't force his way into you. Let me tell you something right now, brothers and sisters. The Word of God says when the outpouring happened in the book of Acts, it was a mighty rushing wind. Could you imagine a news report saying there was a mighty rushing tsunami that hit the land, but then it was gentle and everything was lovely? Think about what I'm saying, brothers and sisters. I mean, it's laughable. The people who don't experience God want to tell you about God. Remember one thing, God Almighty, when he baptizes you in the Holy Ghost and fire, he's literally baptizing and filling you with his power from on high and fire along with the Holy Ghost. A mighty rushing wind, but yet they want to say you don't even realize when it happens. Saints of God, these are people that have a form of godliness but deny the power thereof. From such people, stay away from. You get what I mean? And a wise man or a woman of God would be slow to speak. The Bible says, be slow to speak and quick to listen. And don't be quick to just assume things or mock things, because you don't want to mock something that's actually the Lord and actually from him. Why do I say that? Well, think of the book of Revelation. Think of how Jesus is described, right? Now think of this man is utterly terrified at the presence of Jesus Christ the Judge standing before him. The voice of like many waters, hair whited like wool, eyes as fire, feet as brass tried in the fire. And if I tried to describe that to you, think about this logically. Imagine I tried to describe that to, well, I won't say you. Imagine I tried to describe that to carnal-minded, foolish Christians, like what that man did with my testimony, right? Imagine if I explained, like, if I met Jesus like John did, and I said in a conference, I met Jesus. He had fire in his eyes. He had hair white like wool, and he went back to his house and made a jokey video of a man with like fire coming out of the eyes, and he's like, well, this guy's an idiot. I talk about Jesus had fire in his eyes. But why mock something instead of trying to investigate it and seeing if maybe God can give you the understanding of it? You get what I mean? Because then you'd be mocking something that's holy. These supernatural events are not always easy to describe. I'm just being real with you. Okay, what did Paul say? He said, I knew of a man who went to the third heaven. Right? Whether in the body or out of the body, I can't tell. Who is not even lawful to talk about the things that were seen. Think about that logically. There's some of you would be like, dude's lying. What do you mean, in the body, out of? You couldn't tell? Like, what an idiot. No, he's telling you the truth. How do you know what it's like when you're supernaturally transfigured and translated into the third heaven? You don't know if you're in your body or out of your body. You see what I'm saying? So I wanted to do this video. I don't care how long this message takes. This is such a good word. I don't want to rush it. But I needed to get this video done. Don't mock something just because it's not normal to you or if it's foreign to you. I'm telling you, most Christians have not experienced the actual baptism of the Holy Ghost of fire and been filled. I'm telling you. Now we're going to get into the difference of what it means to receive the Holy Spirit and be baptized and filled with the Holy Ghost. There's a difference, and we're going to get into that. So sit tight. I hope you got an appetite. Amen. But Revelation 4, this was a gateway. This was a portal. This was an opening. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm trying to, at the angle, like, imagine it just, like, opened up, like, enter in. He entered in, and then it shut. You know what I'm saying? I mean, how else could we explain this?
Right? Go to Revelation 19. Revelation 19. Thank you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. So Revelation 19, verse 11 going on. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. This is Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And his eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. Like, would this man have mocked that? If I described that, what if I seen that vision, right? Or you. I won't even use me as an example. Sister, brother, imagine you seeing this, right? You seen the heaven opened up, right? That means it was normal. That means the sky was normal, right? And something happened and it opened up. You see what I'm saying? And you seen Jesus Christ riding through, entering through that dimensional breach, that opening, right? And entering in. And you seen, listen to this again. Where am I at? 11, right? It says, his eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, right? And you tried to explain that to this man that mocked my testimony and made a video about it, right? What would he have done? Gotten some movie of a guy with, like, gasoline burning his face? You know what I'm saying? He's trying to put out the fire and a bunch of crowns falling all off of his head because he don't have the understanding and he's so carnal minded that he would just assume you don't know what you're saying because he don't understand the mystery of it. Do you see where I'm going with this? This is amazing. But I didn't say all of that to say that. I said it to say this, that the windows of heaven were open. There was a portal. There was a gate. There was an opening. You see? It's very simple. Revelation 3:20, here's another door. He says, I stand at the door of your heart and I knock. So there's a spiritual door here that opens up where the Lord comes in. How awesome is that? And remember, I told you we're going to talk about Matthew when Jesus was baptized. Let's just go there now. Go to Matthew chapter 3. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So Matthew chapter 3. Wow, this is amazing. Verse 15 going down. And Jesus answered and said unto him, suffer it to be so now, for thus it is become us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he suffered him. And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water. And lo, the heavens were opened unto him. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. Amazing, right? Y'all enjoying this meal? Thank you, Jesus Christ. So just let's kind of try to visualize this together, shall we? I didn't even give you a dinner plate today. I apologize. Just wanted to cut straight to it. John the Baptist is baptizing God in the flesh, Jesus Christ. Who knows what he heard or if it was just a quiet opening, but he seen it was no longer just the sky. You know what I mean? There was an opening, a door to another dimension that led to heaven. Okay, let that sink in. And he seen the Holy Spirit come down right onto and into Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Like, how could I not walk away? Can you walk away for me? Can you know what I mean? Do the walk away, please. And he hears God the Father speak through that opening, that dimensional door, gateway, window, portal, whatever kind of name you want to call it, same thing. But notice that the Holy Spirit came through the opening and on to Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Wow. I explained in my testimony that I heard this opening in this wind. And then, woof, you know what I'm saying? I say wham, you know what I mean? It wasn't like a sound that said wham, but I can only explain the pressure that went right into my back. You understand? So the same way the Holy Spirit came through the opening and went into Jesus Christ,
right? Because it wasn't like he was just holding on to Jesus' shoulders. Like, let's go. You know what I mean? He was wrapped all around Jesus Christ and in Jesus Christ. Come on, can I get an amen? Right? So, isn't that similar to what happened to me? Huh? So, think about it logically. And we're going to get to the book of Acts next. We're going to get... So, when you look at that, it lines up with my testimony. Because foolish Christians will be like, well, the Lord is omnipresent. He don't have to come through a portal. Well, not according to what we just read. He did come through a dimension. He did come through a door. Even though God is omnipresent, it doesn't mean he's omnipresent the same way. Help me, Lord, with an analogy. Thank you, Holy Ghost. You ready for this? I could call you right now, right? Let's say you're in Florida, Canada, Cali, New York, Chicago, UK, and I'm like, hey, what's going on? Technically, I am with you through the phone. My voice is now with you. Yes or no? I could do a quick recording. Hey, Bless, what's going on? Just want to say I love you in Jesus' name. Click, send, boom. You get the notification. You hit play, and I'm with you. But I'm not physically with you, but I'm with you. I'm just with you in a different way, right? Because I'm actually there, right there. You're seeing my face on the recording on your WhatsApp. I'm just giving you a word of encouragement. And you're like, amen, right? I could write you a letter from my heart. Hey, I just want to let you know, man, that Jesus loves you so much and appreciate all your labor that you do for the Lord and for the ministry. And boom, 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 this is what's been going on. Boom, boom, mail it to you. A week and a half later, you get it. I'm with you in the letter. Do you see what I'm saying? Come on, this is so simple. So God Almighty, yes, omnipresent, but it doesn't mean like the same way. You got to realize something. There is a literal terrifying visitation that happens with the Lord. Okay. There could be times my wife and I and the children, like, I'll give you one that happened that we were in the closet and the Lord was with us. You know what I'm saying? But something happened. We broke through a dimension. Now, whatever. Dimension might not be in the Bible, but that's how I'm describing it to you. Remember, get that dirty mind out of here, okay? We're not dealing with that in this ministry, okay? I don't want to be weirded out to the point where I don't know how to even hold my hands. I'm like, well, if I do this, they're going to say it's a Freemason thing. If I go like this, then a Freemason sign. What do you want me to do? Be like, doth saith the Lord, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not going to be a victim of that. If I'm not a Mason, I don't care. You know what I'm saying? It's as simple as that. These people are so dirty in their mind. Think about what I'm saying, sister. You know you agree, brother. Like, you know what I mean? Like, how do you do with your hands then? Everything you can do is some kind of sign. Look, we talk with our hands. As long as we're not in that evil and we're not deliberately doing it, God has our back. Can I get an amen? So now, let's get back to what I was saying. God was with us in that closet, okay? But as we were worshiping and worshiping and worshiping and singing and crying out to him, I kid you not, this presence of God entered into the closet and like, you could feel him, and even the boys were terrified because you tremble in the presence of God, you know. And he literally showed up, and we were weeping, and like just thinking of that time. But that doesn't happen every day. But I like that though, because it gives you appreciation when he does show up that way. In other words, he's always with us as children of God. But when he chooses to actually come and visit you. Whew, do you see? I hope you get it now, right? So, because he
physically visited Paul on the road to Damascus when he was Saul. Like, he seen him shining as the light. But yet, Jesus was supernaturally with his children all being persecuted. Oh, that's so amazing. Right there, boom, done. Broke it down, amen? So, here we're seeing Matthew. Here we're seeing the baptism in a whole new light. Wow, I'm like sweating. This is amazing. It's a good word. Hallelujah. What about Mark 9? Now, I don't want to go read all of these because we still got to talk about the filling of the Holy Ghost and all that amazing stuff. But Jesus is transfigured. And as you know, Moses and Elijah is talking with Jesus. How did that happen? Think about this logically. Were they all the day long sitting in the sky? Was there an open door that whole time, or did something open and they were able to cross through, they were able to pass through and speak to Jesus Christ? Do you think they stayed? Do you think they went into town to go fishing? Or did they go back into heaven when they were done speaking with the Lord? How did they do that? There was a door, not a wooden door with a doorknob. Although God could do whatever he wants, it could be a supernatural looking door. But I believe they're openings. You know what I'm saying? So read that on your own time about the transfiguration, right? I want you to see in Acts chapter 14, and this is exciting. It's about to get even more exciting, y'all. Hallelujah. So Acts 14, come on, let's go. Look at this. Look at this. Look at this. Hallelujah. Acts 14, let's go to verse 27. And when they were come and had gathered the church together, they rehearsed all that God had done with them and how he had what? Opened the door of faith unto the Gentiles. Wow. So was this a door? This is some kind of wooden door for those mockers out there? Or was this a supernatural door that opened up and God blessed? Let's read it again, because it was a door of faith to the Gentiles. So he released a anointing and a blessing of faith. He opened up the door, sent through the anointing of faith, and the door shut. You know what I'm saying? How could this be so difficult? You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't know. You know what I'm saying? What could I do? 1 Corinthians 16, let's go. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. This is amazing. Wow. This is fun. I'm having fun. Okay, 1 Corinthians 16, let's go. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Look what it says. Go to verse 9. In Jesus' name, for a great door and effectual is opened unto me, and there are many adversaries. Wait a minute, Paul, what you saying to me, brother? Wait a minute, Paul, what you saying to me, brother? Is he talking about a great big physical door somewhere, and adversaries came through? Let's read it again. Verse 9. For a great door and effectual is opened unto me, and there are many adversaries. See, what this means is, Paul was saying there was a great door of heaven that opened up. Something was given to him. Listen, you open a door to pass through it. Let's just keep it real. You know what I'm saying? You open a window, fresh air comes in and out, right? A window, a door, a gateway was opened up. An opening, a portal was opened up, and something amazing happened for Paul at the expense, though, that there was an increase of persecution. It is not a coincidence. It is not a coincidence that as we get done with this conference, trust and believe, there was a window opened up. You are not going to get almost what approximately 300 people together to cry out for the Holy Ghost, and God the Father's like, nah, y'all go somewhere, I'm too busy. You might not have seen a door. Some of y'all felt stuff, and you might not have heard an actual door go and open,
But trust and believe. Why do you think there was a retaliation? Why do you think there was immediate slander that happened online not too long after the conference, saints? Same thing Paul just said. The great doors open and there be many adversaries. You can't see how this ministry has been under attack by slander, but yet a great door opened up because of the faithfulness of the saints gathering together. Woo! Hallelujah. The question is, you coming to the next one? If you didn't make the last one, I hope you can make it to the next one. Amen. In Jesus' name. So, 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12, too, kind of similar about a door opening up. You can read that. Read it, though. Actually read it. But this is amazing. So now what I want to do is, being that I've explained doorway, gateway, I mean, I read the definition to you. I let the phone speak to you through the microphone. I talked to the, you know what I'm saying, whatever you want to call it. I told Google is making y'all markers look stupid. You see what I'm saying? Google got y'all markers looking dumb. Even Google was like, hey, moron, portal means doorway, gateway, opening, window. Now go sit down and repent. You see what I'm saying? So this is the reality of it. We had the excitement of knowing what portal means in the Greek. Pili and Pulon, right? We went through the understanding. See, it takes maturity. That's why I'm telling you. And listen, I'm not in the condemning business. I know to be long-suffering and to be patient and forgiving. But the reality of it is, I've made mistakes. You understand? I've made mistakes. I've seen things and didn't understand it, and I could have judged it wrong when I was young in the Lord. You understand? I myself was learning. Whew, wow. So I know that if people lack an understanding of something, if they don't get it, we're living in a society now where everybody thinks they know it all. That's what's so bad about social media. Is everybody wants to actually correct real teachers. Now, that's not what it means. You don't know what the Bible means. You're going to hell. Lady, are you crazy? You got to understand, like, if you could actually see into people's lives, you know what I'm saying? Like, imagine if you could push a button when people leave the dumbest comments, leave carnal comments, try to challenge men and women of God who have been in the Word for 30 years. Think about that. And act like they know it all and they've been saved a year and a half, right? If you could push a button and actually see into their home, you would see stuff and go, oh yeah, why was I even worried about this clown? Dude's in his tidy whities, eating cereal, hasn't did laundry in a week. He's nasty, but yet he's some prophet. You see what I'm saying? You will be shocked. The people online that are acting like they know it all and they have no clue. No clue. And you know what's amazing is you can't get away with that in anything else. You can't get away with that in anything else. Think about it logically. Try to put on some military uniform like you a Marine and go walking through the mall and come across a real Marine. He gonna check you. He'll be like, well, you ain't no Marine. I can tell you ain't even wearing that right. Try to go to the mechanic and tell the mechanic what's wrong with your car and correct him. And you don't know nothing about an engine. He's going to be like, yo, get out of here. You keep your money. I don't want you here. You're a nuisance. So think of how it feels for men of God that have been in the Word for years, in the Holy Ghost, laboring to teach people online, and they upload a video, and they're in hope and expecting people to be so touched by the revelation and the message. And in the comment section, it's like, well, yeah, I noticed you mentioned Earth, but is it flat or is it round? You're like, lady, that's all you got out of this amazing, phenomenal two-hour message? That's what you had to choose. You could choose one thing to write in the comment section, brother. And you didn't like that I used the word matrix instead of womb. Why'd you say matrix? What is that? Is it even in the Bible? Like, yo, matrix means womb. Did you not know that? See, your mind is stuck on Keanu Reeves. It don't mean I'm not gonna stick to what I know. You see how crazy it can get? I'm telling you, saints. you better back away from those type of crowds of people that are so dark-minded. They could get you with anything. Legit, right now, if you focus long enough in my scenery, you can find something. You could be like, in the back wall. Oh, Wally. I don't know about this guy, Wally. I mean, the messages are on point, they're sound. I can feel the presence of God, but I think I'm counting 13 books. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, no way. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Oh no! He's got 13 books! He's Illuminati! Not Brother Wally, man! I'm gonna have to unsubscribe and I'm gonna have to get on Facebook Live and let everybody know that Wally's Illuminati. He's got 13 books. Shut your mouth! You dirty-minded people! I'm not gonna change and be all worried about my hand movements and be worried about my clothing because your mind is defiled! Yes, I'm bold. Because it's ridiculous. You're making people afraid to be normal. That's why people are so self-conscious before they turn on the camera. They're like, okay, is everything okay, Lord? Am I going to get stoned for wearing a red shirt? Or is this something I should know about? We need to get off of that and just be normal people. Yes, you can't wear a Baphomet shirt. Yes, you can't be throwing up devil horns. This is common sense. But if I happen to be talking and I'm like, oh, hallelujah. And you're like, oh, he just covered one eye. No, I'm in the presence of God, you foolish Galatian. Your mind is like that, not mine. I could care less about going like this and be like, oh, my Lord, I feel your presence. You think I'm thinking about a one eye at that moment? Or am I in the presence of God? Now, if somebody is walking around all day long and they're taking photos and going, throwing up horns and all that, that's a different story. You understand? It's the fruit has to line up with what you're seeing. So I had to take some time to explain that because clearly this is a dangerous sickness, demon and curse in the minds of a lot of people online. That's what's doing it. Too many Illuminati videos, too many false prophets, always trying to point things out. I'll never forget, there was some guy that kept telling me on emails and YouTube, you gotta check out this guy, Jonathan something, you gotta check him out, he's amazing! And I'm like, oh Lord, I ain't got time for this. Like, finally, I'm just like, okay, who's this Jonathan guy? I go to his YouTube channel. This guy legit would take 3-hour videos and break down like the Washington Monument. He would take like a dollar bill and like bend it and fold it and crumple it and be like, you see right there? If you look real closely, you can see aliens on the $20 bill. Bruh, you're OD. Chill. It's time to get normal again and focus on Christ. And if you're around people like that too much, it can mess with your mind. I'm telling you. You got to be balanced in this. Paul said, I know how to abase, I know how to abound. He was in the middle of the lane. He went too fast, too slow with it. He just was cool, calm, and collective. If something happened, he would acknowledge it. Supernatural thing, he would be in. He'd deal with it. You understand what I'm saying? If he seen something that was actually evil, then he would bind it and rebuke it in the name of the Lord. But you have to consider everything. Okay, let's deal with it. Because we got to cut through this with a sword right now. It's done, y'all. Listen, if you can't get into your prayer closet and pray and fast to get that dirty mind off of you, I'm not tolerating it, okay? I'll give you another example. Imagine if you were around and it was internet and you had a phone camera. And you seen Paul getting off the ship. Remember when he took that ship that was a pagan ship? It was the twin gods. Imagine if you recorded Paul on the ship and sent it across social media. I thought Paul was an apostle. Look at him getting off a pagan ship. I told you he was a sorcerer. How wicked. Did that stop him from being the apostle of the Most High God or not? Did he remain an apostle? You see how crazy it can get? I'm telling you right now, there are people afraid to talk now, and they don't know how to sit. They're like, if I put my arm like this, is this some kind of Freemason's position? Okay, I can't sit like this. How about this? Oh, wait, if I fold my hands, it's probably an Illuminati thing. Okay, what if I just put my hands behind my back? Oh, no, that's a Freemason thing, too. Okay, you got some advice? What do I do? Oh, when you do that, too, brother, that's called the Freemason wave. You can't do that either. What do you want? God gave me arms and hands. You see what I'm saying, saints? So don't go crazy with it. Yes, yeah, Brother Wiley just went on what you call a rant for 15 minutes because it's so disgusting. If we upload a message that's anointed and blessed by the Almighty God to bless you, please don't put a stupid comment. Say something lovely and pure and right. Remember, Philippians said, whatsoever things are right, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are good, think on these things. So say something lovely. I don't even say nothing lovely about me. I ain't no insecure man. Say something lovely about the message Jesus fed you. Woo, what a lovely message. I mean, wow. At 32 minutes and 30 seconds in, when the word of the Lord went forth and I just meditated on the Holy Spirit, it was amazing. Click. I'm telling you, saints, this is crazy. People's minds are going into the toilet. Don't follow them. So anyways, let's get back to the message, shall we? I'm telling you. So, we discussed doorways, gateways, portals, right? If I say the word dimension, it's definitely not in the Bible. It's not in the Bible. But a dimension, right? It's so you can kind of understand that heaven is a dimension. Well, maybe dimension is in the Bible. I'm not sure. I'm going to have to double check that. But you get my point. And if you really want to get technical with it, the word Bible ain't in the Bible. Should I not use the word Bible? We can't get that way, saints. When you allow people to try to bind you with that witchcraft, and you're afraid to use certain words, you don't know what words to say, you don't know what hand signs, you don't know how to do anything, forget all of that. You know what I'm saying? But these are dimensional openings that God communicates from heaven to the earth. That's amazing. So, with that being said, let's move on to the next discussion. Well, man of God, you broke down the portal. I get it now. But what about the Holy Spirit? Like, how do I know I'm filled? If I'm not filled with the Holy Ghost, if I didn't experience what you experienced, does that mean I don't have God? And again, this is what these wicked Christians do. I'm not talking most of y'all. I'm not even talking to you. You know what I'm saying? Most of y'all are mature believers. You actually walk with Jesus. You're not a religious lunatic. And all of this is logical to you. It makes sense, as they would say, right? So, in that message, in the mystery of the tabernacle, when I was describing being filled with the Holy Ghost and fire, there's a difference between being filled with the Holy Ghost and fire and receiving the Holy Spirit when you give your life to Jesus Christ. And this is what we're going to go through. This is what we're going to go through now. So, in the book of Acts, if we can go there right now, chapter 2. Let's go to the book of Acts. Come on. Chapter 2. Hallelujah. This is amazing, and I am sweating like no joke, y'all. There's no joke. Verse 1 going down. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with what? One accord in one place. Why do you think there's so much biting and devouring and slander? And the enemy's trying to cause division so that way this doesn't come to pass in your life. You better not let this enemy trick you. Look what it says. And suddenly, you hear that now? There came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting.
And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and it sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. So, I'm just going to get straight to it because I don't have time to beat around a bush, okay? That foolish man who made that video mocking something that was actually real. It was a real testimony of something that really happened. Saints of God, let me ask you a question. From what I described to you, right? How there was a sudden rushing wind. When I said wham, that was me describing the power of God going into my back and filling into my entire body, my belly, right? And I told you there was a rushing wind. It was, I could hear it all over my ears. Like it was almost like being inside of an F5 tornado, but being at peace. You see what I'm saying? This is exactly what happened to them. What kind of person would make a video mocking the wind of the Almighty when concerning the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire? Who would be that crazy to mock that? And let's keep it real. Who would be that wicked to laugh at it? Wow. Wow. So let me ask you a question. Did the Holy Spirit and all the wind and the fire, you know what I'm saying, enter in through the door after taking an Uber there and say, hey, I'm here, let me fill in you? Or did a dimension open up? Did a window open up? Now that you've already read all the other scriptures on Pili and Pulan, the portals, the dimension, the openings, the window, the door, the gateway, whatever name you prefer. Because no servant is greater than the master. If the windows of heaven opened up over the Son of God, and God the Father sent down the Holy Ghost, and Jesus, as God Almighty, was given the Holy Spirit without measure, and we're going to get into that in a moment. The exact same thing happened here with the children of God in the upper room. They were in one accord. Heaven opened up, and the wind came through, filled that place, and they were filled with the Holy Ghost and fire. Plain and simple. Amazing. And remember in Luke, it says that you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire. We'll get into that. This is amazing. So now you just read this in the book of Acts, right? This is the most important part of your life. And if this hasn't happened to you, why are you not pursuing it? Why did you give up so easily? Oh, you tried for a few days, you fasted, nothing happened, you went back to normal? Let me tell you something. Be that old lady Jesus was describing who wouldn't leave the king alone until he heard her cry. Knock on God Almighty's door in Jesus Christ's name every single day of your life. Now, I want to go through the difference of what it means to have the Holy Spirit. Am I always filled with the Holy Spirit? Does he come into my spirit and then leave sometimes and come back? No. There is a difference. Okay, go to John chapter 3. Come on. Let's go. John chapter 3. Look at what it says now. Verse 34, for he whom God hath sent speaketh the words of God, for God giveth not the Spirit by measure unto him. Did you hear that? For God, listen to this now, we're going to read it again. For God giveth not the Spirit by measure unto him, speaking of who? Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Wait right here. I'm going to go get something. Now, I said wait right here. This is not an Illuminati. This is not like a secret Freemason code for you dark-minded people in the back. I'm just saying, wait right here. Just hold on. I'm going to go get something. I'll be right back. Here we go. This is a measuring cup. Can I get an amen? Right? And this is going to represent the Holy Spirit, per se. It's really low budget oil, you feel me? But great value. But anyways, this is going to represent the Holy Spirit. So here we have a measuring cup. I know you're going to really appreciate it. You really took the time out to stick through this message with me. You done dealt with a few rants. If that's okay. Am I allowed to use that word? This right here. Remember the word there. The key word in that scripture was God giveth not the spirit to him by... Hold on. Let me read it word for word now. For God giveth not the spirit by measure unto him. Right? So this is a measuring cup. That means that Jesus Christ was always filled with the Holy Ghost. Always filled. But there are going to be times in your life, right? Like, let's go to an actual example. Go to Acts chapter 4. All right, I'll just give you one example. I want to use someone other than Jesus because he was always filled, okay? But Acts chapter 4, verse 8. In Jesus' name, look what it says now. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, you rulers of the people and elders, wow, you see this, of Israel, if we this day be examined of good deed done to the impotent man, by what means he is made whole, be it known unto you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. Now, why does it specifically mention that in this particular moment, Peter was filled with the Holy Ghost? It's because at that moment, he needed to be filled with the Holy Ghost to speak with such boldness and authority to the people. But if he was chilling at the house with his wife, watching a godly movie on Amazon Prime, I don't think he needed to be filled with the Holy Ghost at that moment. Because you got to realize something. When you get the Holy Ghost to move upon you, it is no joke. The power can sometimes, you literally can't handle it at times. So, there's other times where, like, let me go to, for example, look at verse 31. It says, and when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. Now, at this time, these are the saints of God who have already received the Holy Spirit. They've already given their life to Christ, right? They're believing in the Lord. So how come all of a sudden they were filled? Because at that moment, God had a mission for them, and there was an increase of boldness for them. I'll give you one more because this next one is going to really help you to understand better. Because I'm about to break it all down by the grace of God. Thank you, Jesus. Go to chapter 9 of Acts. Go to verse 17. Wow. And Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hand on him, said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus, hath appeared unto thee, and the way thou came hath sent me, that thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. You see that? So that at that moment, God had such a mission for Paul that he needed to fill him up. Let me ask you a question. Brother, sister, let's say you guys want to go on a quick little vacation. You know, a little ghetto vacation. You call it a ghetto vacation. It's a little 3-hour drive somewhere for a day or two. Not going to break the budget. You know what I'm saying? If you got to hit the highway, brother, sister, do you fill the tank? Or do you just throw a quick little 10 in it? You fill it, right? You put the whole $40 in and get that all the way to the... If you're like me and it doof, you keep going. You don't listen to the doof sound, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm talking about when the trigger pop move because it's telling you you can't fill it anymore. You keep, let me get a couple more drops in there. But if, brother, if you were just like, you know, around town or your city, you wouldn't have an urgency to fill your gas tank up because you're not hitting the highway. But if you had to go on a long road trip, you would need to fill the gas tank all the way up. Now, do you see what I'm saying? So God decides how much of the Holy Ghost to give you at any moment or time of your life, every day. If you're just chilling around the house and you're hanging out with the Lord, He doesn't have to fill you with the Holy Ghost at that moment. Unless, you know, you might be in the prayer closet and He wants you to prophesy and speak life into this dimension, into this realm, into this place, whatever word works for you, okay? I think realm is okay, right? Was he willing? Yeah, I was going to say something. But He doesn't always have to fill you with the Holy Ghost, but the Holy Ghost will still be in you. Do you see it now? Oh, this is so good. So remember the time where there was a false prophet? Go to chapter 13 of Acts. Verse 9. Watch this. But Elymas the sorcerer, for so is his name by interpretation, withstood them, seeking to turn away the deputy from the faith. Now watch this. Then Saul, who is called Paul, filled with the Holy Ghost, set his eyes on him and said, O, full of all trickery and all mischief, thou child of the devil, thou enemy of all righteousness, wilt thou not stop to pervert the right ways of the Lord? And now, behold, the hand of the Lord is upon thee, and thou shalt be blind and not seeing the sun for a season. And immediately that man went blind. Are y'all ready for it? You're going to love this so much. You're going to glorify Christ because your understanding is going to be opened. Let's say Paul, I'm doing this for you now. Let me see. Is that close enough? Is that better right there? Is that good? Let's say Paul, before he went to go see that man to bring the gospel to him, before that sorcerer tried to deceive him, let's say Paul had that much of the Holy Ghost at that moment when he was maybe walking through town. But when he entered in and he started to bring the gospel to that man, and the sorcerer, who, mind you, a sorcerer had real power, witchcraft power. So now there's a supernatural fight going on. At that moment, God the Almighty, Jesus Christ, at that moment decides, I gotta fill in my servant Paul. I gotta fill in him so he'll have enough power to break all the sorcery that's being operated through that worker of iniquity and blind him. That's going to take a lot of Holy Ghost to push forth that type of spiritual weapons and power to blind that man so all will fear. Are you serious right now? Do you get it now? It's not that, oh, you just all day long filled with the Holy Ghost. You couldn't handle that. Listen, when the Holy Ghost starts filling in me, I'll end up on my face. He's so powerful. Sister, brother, have you ever been in the presence of God and you could just feel Him moving all over your body? You feel Him in your stomach. You just feel Him. Now, do you know, as I describe that, people with a corrupt mind are like, honey, you know, it's God. These are people that will never get touched, sadly, because their mind is so poisoned. They need to pray and fast. But you see, you pure-minded people out there, what did you do? Oh, amen, I've been there. You were like, oh, the Lord was all over me. You remember feeling God almost like a hot blanket just surrounding you? You could feel the burning in your belly. And then it got too strong to the point where your flesh started to tremble. That's exactly what I mean. Now, do you think that when Paul was done being used by God to, because do you know how much supernatural power it took to break all that witchcraft off of that place that sorcerer was using and to blind that man supernaturally? Do you know how much power that took? But once he was done, Hopefully this don't make a mess, y'all. If I make a mess, y'all gonna help me clean this up. You feel me? I ain't gonna leave this to Lioness. Can I get an amen? Right? But I knew it. Okay. That's it. I'm not even gonna risk it. But God would remove a lot of his presence from Paul because he doesn't need all this presence of the Holy Ghost unless it's needed. You get what I'm saying? So when supernatural things are needed to be done, I'm just going to leave that there for the rest of the sermon until I'm done. You feel me? But you get the point that if you're just going about your day and God doesn't have something supernatural for you to do, then he's not going to fill you at that moment. But you need the initial, that's the word I'm looking for. You need the initial baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire to open up the dimension, the gateway or the door, okay, or the window or the portal. And you, did you know that? Remember what Jesus said, I stand at the door and knock if you let me in. What door do you think? You think you got like a wooden door on your chest? He got to enter into you supernaturally, like entering through a portal or a doorway or a gateway, right? But let's say you're walking down the street. Wow, that's a lot of oil. Let's say you're walking down the street and, you know, some terrible accident happens and someone's like dying. At that moment, God could fill in you so you would have enough power to heal that person in Jesus' name. For example, when we were at the conference, approximately almost 300 people. And there was a gentleman who said that there was at one point that I stopped in the middle of the deliverance prayer, or kind of in the beginning, I think. And I said, I declare that it is not by my power, but by the power of Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, that these devils must come out. And he said that when he heard me after that, my voice was not the same. It's like he could hear Jesus inside of me. Jesus was speaking. At that moment, what he don't know is I had burning all over my body. You see, God increased the Holy Ghost in me by measure. Remember, Jesus, listen to what it says now in John. Remember what it said, that he, Jesus, was given the Holy Spirit without measure. That means Jesus was always filled with the Holy Ghost. But he's the only one that can handle that. I need you to get an example so you can understand what I'm saying. You know what? Let's talk about Moses. Go to Exodus 17 with me. I want to show you something just real quick to help you get a better understanding of what I'm talking about. Are you enjoying this message? Because I know I am. It's a really fun message. Thank you, Holy Ghost. So Exodus, let's go. 17. Look at what it says in Jesus' name. Verse 10 going down. In chapter 17, it says, so Joshua did as Moses had said to him and fought with Amalek, and Moses and Aaron and Hur went up to the top of the hill. You got to realize what that means. That hill, there's a supernatural meaning here. God was trying to tell you that you got to get higher with him. Even the book of Acts, they were in the what? The upper room. There's something about getting into the heavenly realm, right? Okay, but look at this. And it came to pass when Moses held up his hand that Israel prevailed. And when he let it down, the Amalekites prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy, and they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat therein. And Aaron and Hur stayed up his hands, and the one on the one side and the other on the other side, and his hands were ready until the going down of the sun. Now, let's try to picture this. This is going to be like a mini rod that Moses had, right? Whenever he would lift it up, the children of Israel would start really supernaturally defeating their enemy. Like, you can imagine they increased in power when the rod was lifted up over them. But if it was brought down, the Amaleks would start prevailing and winning. But the problem was, there was so much power in that rod,
it was hard for him to hold on. He was like, I can't handle this anymore. Like, ah. And he needed to sit on the stone, which represents who? Come on, who holds you up? And he needed two to help him, where two or more are gathered. Can I get an amen? And they helped him with the power of God that was in the rod. I got a message coming out called the Rod of God, but it's in the kitchen cooking. I got to wait on the Lord. So I use that example to help you understand that if it was hard for Moses, mighty man of God, to hold up just a rod that represented the power of God, because imagine the force. It would, you know what it's kind of like? I could imagine. Do you remember when you were younger and you went to like a farm or something? Even if you're from the city or the hood, there's always a farm, like an animal farm, like, you know what I mean? Maybe in like the next town over or something. Have you ever touched one of those fences that it doesn't like, but it kind of like, it like kind of zaps you? It'd be like holding on to that. You know what I'm saying? Like, how long could you do that? You can't handle it, right? So the rod represented the Holy Ghost, right? The power of God. So imagine if Moses can't even handle holding up that rod for a period of time. Do you think you can actually handle being filled with the Holy Ghost all day long for the rest of your life? Do you know how much power that is, that force? I'm telling you. If you ever met someone that's like, all right, I'm filled with the Holy Ghost all the time, they're very immature. Don't stone them. Just understand they don't know what they're talking about. Okay? So I gave you that analogy now with a measuring cup to let you know that God might have you at a measurement like that tomorrow. But a couple days from now, he might measure you a little higher depending on what he needs to do through you. Oh, that's so good. Sister, you know you're the prudent one. You know what I mean? If you went on a trip with your husband and children, you as a prudent wife and mother will say, okay, well, honey, how many days are we leaving? Oh, we're going to be gone for just a day. Okay, well, just one night? Okay, I'm gonna travel light. We'll just have one suitcase. Everybody will have one outfit, washcloth, boom, boom, boom. But if your husband said, oh, we're going to travel for 5 days, then you're like, oh, man, I got to pack a lot of stuff. See, depending on how much you need for the trip or the mission at hand is what you will do. The same thing applies with God. He's going to give you a measurement according to what he needs you to do. Now, if you're rebellious, disobedient, why is he going to fill you with the Holy Ghost, knowing that you're not even living right to begin with? If you live righteous and holy and you seek him, I'm telling you, he will fill you. Now, I am overwhelmed by this message and I got to finish it. So now let's go to John 20. Okay, go to John 20. And again, guys, brothers and sisters, this message can be broken down into like quite a bit. Okay, so John 20. I'm trying my best to sum it all up, but it's not that easy. So Gospel of John chapter 20. Look at what it says in verse verse 19 going down. Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and said unto them, peace be unto you. Isn't that amazing? So that fear had to leave as soon as Jesus said that. And when he had said, he showed unto them his hands and his side, and then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Okay, now watch this. Then said Jesus unto them again, peace be unto you, as my Father hath sent me, even so send I you. There's a reason he said it twice. I'm not going to get into that, but some of y'all might know. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said what? Receive you the Holy Ghost. Now, let me ask you a question. So in John 20, he breathed. He said, receive you the Holy Ghost. At that moment, they did receive the Holy Ghost. But let me ask you a question, my highly intelligent brother and sister. Were they filled with the Holy Ghost at that moment? No. But they had the Holy Spirit. Do you see it? It wasn't until the book of Acts in the upper room, they were filled with the Holy Ghost and fire, because now it was time for the great mission. Send them on their way. He want to send them off with a full tank of what? Spiritual gas. This is so, see how simple it is. Amen. Hallelujah. Now wait. Wait, let's talk about this. Acts 1:8 is going to blow your mind. Let's go. Acts 1:8 is going to amaze you. Look at what it says. In Jesus' name. It says, "But you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in all Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth." You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost shall come upon you. That means he's gonna break through. Jesus Christ is gonna lay his hands on you and push and fill you with the Holy Ghost and fire, and that wind is gonna run. It's gonna rush. Now let me ask you a question. Let's recap the baptism of Jesus Christ. Notice that it was in the river Jordan. How many of y'all know what Jordan means? Do you know that Jordan means one from above who comes down or descends? So when I heard there was people laughing and mocking that video and saying, the Holy Ghost don't need to come through no portal, and he's there already, and what's this wind stuff? And crazy, you know. Crazy how people could have no fear of God. I don't want no parts with that. No way. No way. No way. No way. So we're going to kind of go back and forth, but I really want to talk to you about something. In the book of Acts chapter 19, you read it on your own time. There was a time they questioned somebody and they said, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit since you believed?" And the person said, "I didn't even know there was a Holy Spirit." But that's because he was not introduced to Jesus Christ yet. He was taught the teaching of John the Baptist. They taught him about Jesus Christ. You see the difference. Now, the word filled, what does that word mean to you? I can't front y'all, I'm exhausted. I've been like really not sleeping the best I can these past few days with everything going on and having to, you know, do the videos I had to do and everything. But I'm really doing this for y'all because the Lord loves you so much, and we love you, and we want you to really get this blessed meal. So pray for my strength, amen, in Jesus' name. Pray for my wife too, because when I'm distracted and doing everything, that's a double load on her too. You see what I'm saying? So, and of course, pray for the boys, you know what I mean? And pray for everybody. Amen, amen, amen. So, the word filled, what does that mean to you? Filled, right? Like, okay, this Fiji water. Now, in my opinion, I'm not a fan of Fiji, right? There's a new alkaline water that my wife began. It's just, like I said, y'all, get good water if you're able to. Spend the extra $3. You need to get good water in your body. But anyways, Fiji's all right. But when I first bought this, I need a drink. When I first bought this bottle, it was pretty much filled to the top. But it's not filled anymore, you see? It's not. So, all right, I'm going to have to drink more water to show you an example. So let's say today you wake up. That's the amount of the Holy Spirit that God the Father decides that you need, right? And later on that day, you know, you end up going to war in the prayer closet, and the amount of Holy Ghost and fire that was needed so you could fight principalities and powers in the heavenly realm with power, amen? But let's say the next day, you're really not going to leave the house. It's just going to be a regular day. You're going to do cleaning. I probably look mad goofy drinking that. I totally drank it wrong. But now you got less water, right? Because you don't need a tremendous amount of the presence of God at that moment. So, anyways, the point is being filled means literally being filled. Now, think about this. I want you to write these down. I'm not going to read them to save time. I think that's fair.
Luke chapter 4, verse 28, they were filled with wrath. Okay? And these are bad things that I'm bringing to you to let you know that the enemy also wants to try to fill you. Isn't that interesting? So you're like this bottle, right? And there's a war going on to see who can fill you with what. Isn't that interesting? And praise God, we glorify Christ because he won. Amen? Next, I want you to write madness. That's Luke chapter 6, verse 11. They were filled with madness. Write down John chapter 16, verse 6. They were filled with sorrow. Do you see that? Right? Now, Luke chapter 5, verse 26, they were filled with the fear of God. Now, that's a good one, right? But I'm trying to prove a point to you that the same way it would be so simplified, right, if I said, okay, if I use just one as an example, let's go to Luke 4, okay? So, Luke chapter 4. Right, verse 28. Watch what it says. Okay, in Jesus' name. And all they in the synagogue, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath. Right? So, they were filled with wrath. But do you think they remained filled with wrath for the rest of their life? No, it's like, how many of y'all, we'll say when you were in the world, were utterly filled with wrath before? You know, sister, your boyfriend, when you were lost in the world, you thought he loved you and cheated on you with your homegirl, and you were so filled with wrath that you would have done the dumbest stuff and regretted it for the rest of your life if the enemy had his way. But you didn't remain filled with wrath. Right? Eventually, the wrath filled in you when you were angry in the world, when they betrayed you like that. But eventually, what? The wrath lowered and, boop, disappeared. You were no longer filled with wrath. 3 months later, you dumped that loser anyways, and you ended up giving your life to Christ. And you ended up getting a lovely husband, right? But you didn't remain filled with the wrath, right? See how simple this is? See, the enemy tried to fill you all the way up with wrath, hoping that you'll do something crazy and regret it for the rest of your life. But eventually, that wrath had to lower down and disappear. Well, if it's like that with these things, think about it logically with the Holy Ghost. There's sometimes you'll be filled with the Holy Ghost to do something God needs you to do. And then other times, he's going to be in you in a certain way where it's not overwhelming for you, but he's still going to be in you. And I know some of you guys, some of you brothers and sisters, you get discouraged when you hear me tell you my testimony. Like, I ain't never heard no rushing wind and fire going through my back into my belly. But that doesn't mean the Holy Spirit isn't in you. It just means you haven't been baptized and filled with the Holy Ghost and fire yet. Now, you better seek for him. Amen? Don't just sit back and think it's not for you. No, you need to go do that. You need to pray and fast and read the word and worship and the seven pillars. You know what they are. So, keep writing these down. Acts chapter 5, right? Before that, though, let's go to Romans 1, just real quick. Romans 1:29, it says, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy and murder and debate. Whew, I'm running out of breath. See, the devil wants to try to fill you up as his glass, as his bottle. Because he knows if he can fill you, you'll have more power for it. Wow, that's good. You'll have more power for him to use. That's why you got to abstain from sin, so he don't fill you with his stuff. Wow. But God wants to fill you, and may he fill you. Amen? So now, in the book of Acts chapter 5, verse 3, if we go there real quick, chapter 5, verse 3, look at what it says in Jesus' name. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Ghost? See, the devil filled to the brim the heart of Ananias with the spirit of lying and greed. And think about that. Wow. Wow. Go to verse 17 of that same chapter, though. And the high priest rose up, and all they that were with him was in the sect of the Sadducees were filled with indignation. You see? So these different things. Acts 13:45, write that down. They were filled with envy. In other words, sister, some of you have had a friend, right, where you thought you were cool with her when your life wasn't going right, but you met a man, you ended up marrying him, and she don't have a husband. She started getting envious. Then you ended up having an amazing child. She got more envious. Then you ended up getting your first. You guys bought a house together. But the envy was filling in her until it got all the way to the top. And she got so envious, she tried to seduce your husband when you weren't home one day to try to break your marriage. Of course, your husband remained faithful, Lord willing. Amen. But do you see what I mean? So the devil's slowly trying to fill people with stuff until it gets to the brim where it's maximum power. The same way God will fill us with the Holy Ghost when he needs us to use maximum power. But if not, we'll just have the Holy Spirit at a certain measurement. Wow. Wow. This one is deep. In Acts chapter 19, in Acts chapter 19, verse 29, it said the whole city was filled with confusion. You see that? So even a city can be filled with a spirit of confusion. Now it's about to get exciting. Write this down. Acts chapter 13, 52, it says they were all filled with joy. Ain't that awesome? And of course, you could write 2 Timothy 1, 4. Paul does talk about, I want you to be filled with joy. Acts chapter 3, verse 10, they were all filled with wonder and amazement. Write that down. Acts chapter 4, verse 17, they were all filled with gladness. Have you ever been in such the joy of the Lord, nothing can take your joy? There's just too much joy, it's overflowing, and we're going to get into that in a minute. Remember what David said in Psalms 23, my cup what? Runneth over. You want that because you want to overflow onto other people. Oh, that's good. That's good. Thank you, Jesus. Acts chapter 4, 17, they were all filled with gladness. You see? Wow. Philippians 1, 11, he desired to be filled with the fruits of righteousness. Colossians 1:9, to be filled with the knowledge of his will and all wisdom and understanding. Are you serious right now? Wow. Wow. And that's John 7 where I said, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. Because once you get filled, God wants you to flow onto others. Remember? Okay. Oh, that's so good. Now, don't laugh at me, but I'm going to have to wet up the table for this analogy. Let me move that, the Strong's. Do you remember when Peter was sent to Cornelius, the honorable Italian from the Italian band, the man of God? Who would do alms and his prayers were heard before God, and Peter was on the roof and God had to tell him, look, just because he's not Hebrew, I've made him clean with my blood. I want you to imagine Peter at this moment is filled with the Holy Ghost, right? When he gets to Cornelius's place. And remember what happened. It said that as Peter was preaching to them, the Holy Ghost fell on them. And they all were filled with the Holy Ghost. Now think about that. I want you to imagine that when David said, my cup runneth over. Or remember what Jesus said in Luke chapter 6. If we just go there real quick as well. Because that's going to be a good, it'll parallel with what I'm saying to you. Hold on, let me get there. Luke chapter 6 here. Where we going? 38. Come on. It says in Jesus' name. Be therefore, give and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and what? Running over. This is amazing. Shall men give into your bosom, for with the same measure that you meet with all, it shall be measured unto you. There Jesus goes with that amazing word measure again. Oh, that was perfect. I wasn't even expecting that. But imagine your cup runneth over. This is Peter now. He's filled to the brim with the Holy Ghost, and he's like a human cup, right? When he gets to Cornelius, as he's preaching, I know, right? Only Brother Wally is splashed up his dinner table, to give you an analogy. I hope I didn't get the computer. Right? The water from his cup, the Holy Spirit poured out from Peter and landed all over them, and they were filled with the Holy Ghost. How amazing. That's why it's so important for you. I kind of, like, I got a whole lot of water on the table right now. But that's why it's so important for you to be filled, so your cup can run over onto others. That's why a lot of you, like, man, when we get together with conferences, we feel the Holy Ghost presence so strong. That's because our cup is running over onto you. We were praying and fasting, getting filled a greater measurement of the Spirit of God. Oh, that's so good. Be real. Isn't it so? Has your understanding opened up? Because a lot of y'all were worried, because you've been taught by people that are not supposed to be teaching. They'll either say, well, no, you don't have the Holy Spirit at all. Have you spoken tongues? No? Well, the Holy Spirit is not in you. What? Who says that? What about Elizabeth? What about her husband? Do you know both of them were filled with the Holy Ghost? And they didn't even speak in tongues. They prophesied. Oh, that's so good. John the Baptist, filled with the Holy Ghost from the womb. Huh? Saints, we do got to wrap up. I do got to get to bed. You know what I'm saying? Literally, it's like the sun will be coming up. But so we're breaking all of this down. I know. There's so many scriptures I want to get into. I just really, honestly, it's late. You know what I'm saying? I still want to pray with y'all. I don't even know how long it's been. I don't know how long this video is. But, so, can we at least go back and break? Let me wipe this up. I'll be right back. Okay, I had to take a brief intermission to clean up the water, okay? But I'm glad I did that, because it helped you to see that when Peter showed up, his cup overflowed onto the Cornelius in them. See, you want to be filled. But anyways, the point proven is, I want us to recap here. So we discussed, as far as my description, don't let your mind be corrupted by these people on YouTube to the point where I could describe a holy testimony to you. And because I used the word portal instead of doorway or gateway, that made a person utterly, completely mock and discredit the truth of my testimony. Think of the immaturity. Think of the foolishness of that person. So you got to avoid people like that, and ask God to help you to grow and mature. Remember what Paul said: when I was a child, I thought like a child. You see, that's a childish way to think. Always judging by outward appearances and always thinking the wrong and negative and being pessimistic. And pessimism is a bad demon. You want to be balanced. Okay, but I explained to you about portal, how in Genesis, that's a gateway, an opening opened up. God came through, angels ascending and descending, right? We went through that when they were baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire in the book of Acts, they already received the Holy Ghost in the letter in the Gospel of John. See, it was different. It was a different measurement, right? And beside, the Bible says, if you confess Jesus Christ is Lord, God dwelleth in you and you dwell in God. And one cannot say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit, right? So when you confess Jesus as Lord in sincerity, at that moment, the Holy Spirit of Christ will enter into you. He will literally enter in. But you're supposed to get baptized in water. Okay, don't let anybody try to make you rebellious to prove a point and not get you baptized. If you're not baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth into the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost in water, you need to get it done, okay? Then, that not always the order, but I'm just saying, then you got to pursue God. Seek Him, seek Him, seek Him. I don't care if it's 5 months straight. When I was baptized correct in the name of Jesus Christ, I was seeking Him for like 3 months. I'm talking, I was out of strength. I was almost ready to give up. And He visited me that, I'm telling you, if only you could have seen it like a movie. Wow. So we discussed all of this, right? But I want that testimony to happen for you. But until then, be of good cheer. Be encouraged. If you're walking with Christ, he's in you. He just hasn't filled in you. But what the question is, why? What's going on in your life? Is there sin in your life? Are you carnal? Are you religious? Are you lazy? Do you not seek him enough? Are you the master of your domain? You know what I mean? Where you decide how much you're going to pray? It don't work that way. There's times where I was seeking the Lord and I thought I was done and God was like, keep going. Same thing with my wife. So find out why. Remember the mystery of the tabernacle. It was a fire by night and a pillar of smoke by day. There's that Holy Ghost and fire symbolism. But the tabernacle has to be accurately built up. Are you an accurately built up tabernacle where God can say, now I could use you. Here, let me fill you with my presence. Because saints, God is not going to fill you with the Holy Ghost sitting down watching a movie with your wife. There's no need for that. But if he sends you on a mission to fight a neighborhood of witchcraft workers, he's going to want to fill you with more power to fight that supernatural evil power. Do you get what I'm saying? Just like how there's good portals and how the Illuminati is trying to open up CERN and open up dark portals. There's good portals and bad portals. Now, what kind of evil person, when I'm describing God Almighty, would think or make a video and mock that an evil portal opened up over me? I'm going to let it be known right now. The chances of that man losing his salvation is very, very dangerous right now because he mocked something that's very sacred and holy. Even mocking the rushing wind, I'm letting you know who you are. Step down and go repent and fast and pray that the Lord will have mercy on you because I know you're going to watch this video. You better repent. You better step down from the position you're at and you better go repent that the Lord will have mercy on you. Because judgment is coming to you. It wasn't about striking at his servant, trying to slander me. But when you mock the rushing wind and make people laugh at it, the blood be on your head. And for any of you that seen that video and you laughed, you better repent. You better repent. And you better get right with the Lord. And you better study your word so you know. So you have an understanding, so you have wisdom, and God will teach you these mysteries so you don't mock or make fun of something that is going to come back around and judge you. Just like the Eli priest when he was like mocking the woman. He didn't know she was praying. He accused her of being drunk. And the baby that God would give her would come back around and bring judgment to him. So I think I did, at least for this part one, we discussed these amazing portals, these doorways, these gateways, right? We discussed how, you know, you can receive the Holy Spirit when you give your life to Christ. And remember, God breathed in Adam. He was a living soul. Jesus breathed into us. We became a quickened spirit, you see? Isn't that awesome? So we talked about these things. We talked about Jesus was always filled. He was always filled. But we're given the Holy Spirit by measure. I gave you what to write down on what to watch out for that the enemy would try to fill you with, right? Wrath, madness, sorrow, confusion, envy, indignation, you know, but the Lord wants to fill you with joy and wonder and amazement, gladness, fruits of righteousness, filled with knowledge of his will and all wisdom and understanding. How awesome is that, right? We want our cup to runneth over. Now you're encouraged, ain't you? You believe in the Lord. You've had the wrong teachers discourage you that God is not inside of you. That's a lie. I got two scriptures I'm going to put on the screen. But you got to pursue to get filled with the Holy Ghost and fire. Don't be satisfied with just having God in you. Seek him. Remember what he said? Jesus was telling us. If you being wicked know how to give good to your children, how much more will the Father give the Holy Ghost to those who ask? But you have to ask in sincerity. Remember, the Bible says a person can ask amiss. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. You got to ask with faith and believe, but you got to be living right.
How could God want to fill somebody with the Holy Ghost that's living a nasty lifestyle, living in adultery, living in sin, living in some type of evil, and God is going to fill you with the Holy Ghost? Think about that. Clean up your life. Start to pursue the fruit of the Holy Spirit. If you want to be filled with the Holy Spirit, desire His character. Woo! Did you catch that? Wow! If you want to be filled with the Holy Ghost, desire His personality. Desire His fruit first. That'll prove that you want to be filled with Him. Remember, the Bible says, prove your repentance by your deeds. Meet fruit met for repentance, the Bible says. Right? So, it's not just about grace as a doormat. It's a doorway. Right? So, desire to be filled with the Holy Ghost and fire. And don't give up, sister. Don't give up, brother. Pray and fast. Read your word. Cry out to the Lord. Repeat. Pray, fast. Read your word. Cry out to the Lord. Repeat. And if you get hit with a cold like I did, who cares? Blow your nose while you worshiping. Makes no difference. And I hope you don't get hit with a cold. Amen. But seek Christ. And I'm telling you, there will come a time, if you do it sincere, you will hear the windows of heaven opened up. Jesus Christ, the high priest, he's going to step through and lay his hands. And he's going to push and put that mighty wind. You're going to hear the wind. And that Holy Ghost and fire is going to fill in you. That's my hope for all of you out there that love Jesus. But until then, you still have God in you. Okay? You just can't go on missions that maybe someone like me who's been filled can. I mean, I'm not the only one. I know an elder. Do you know he is the only man I've ever met that had the same experience that I had? The only elder. I absolutely honor this man. And me and him, we don't talk. You know what I mean? I love him. He loves me. But sometimes two men that we don't need to be together. He got to do what he got to do for the gospel. I'm over here. It's like Paul and Barnabas. You know what I'm saying? I'm not trying to say I'm Paul and he's Barnabas. I know those men were greater than us. But I'm trying to prove a point. This man, when he described it, I'm just sitting there going, wow, finally, I met another man. He said, Wally, he said, I was laying in my bed. I've been pursuing. I've been trying to get filled with the Holy Ghost. I would not let go. I told God, I'm not going to stop bothering you until you fill me. He would walk up and down his job at night when he was a security officer, whatever he was. And every single night he would ask. He was praying and fasting, ribs showing. It didn't matter. One night he's laying on his back. See, I was laying on my face. He was laying on his back. You get what I mean? So it's not like this isn't yoga where you got to be in a certain position. But just get down, though. I'm telling you, when you get on your face, it's beautiful. But he said, I was laying in my bed. And all of a sudden, it's like windows opened up over me. This wind just came rushing. And I just felt this fire go all through my body. Remember, Jeremiah said, it's like a fire what? Shut up in my bones. And do you know how much relief I had to hear another man describe what I went through? How do you think I feel when I tell people about it? And they kind of walk away going, do you believe him? It's crazy because I could tell a room of 500 people my experience, but if 500 people have never experienced it, it's going to be a natural thing for them to get tempted to be like, I don't know about that. I mean, my pastor back in Texas told me that I'm filled with the Holy Spirit the minute I just say Jesus. You see what I'm saying? But I'm not going to stop telling my testimony because of mockers. And I hope that there's a season and a time. I really believe that it starts off with small pockets of fire to begin with anyways. It's like God sent one man into that city. He sent Jonah into that city and it erupted a fire. He sent Peter into Cornelius' home and it started a fire. You see what I'm saying? So there has to be true men and women of God that will seek God until they're filled with the Holy Ghost and fire, and that they can overpour. Their cup can runneth over onto others. But do you desire the Holy Ghost the way you should? Or is he in the back burner of your life? And then you want to complain why you're not filled. Put him in the front. Show him he's number one. Show him he's all your desire. Even if you go about your life, you got a husband or a wife or children and a job. Yes, you got to do what you got to do, but have the Holy Ghost on your mind all day long. Tell Jesus all day long, Lord Jesus, fill me today with the Holy Ghost and fire. Lord, I'm checking everything. Sprinkle me with your blood. I've abstained from sin. Lord, fill me with the Holy Ghost and fire. Lord, I'm not going to stop bothering you, Lord. Remember, Elisha would not let Elijah go. And he got the blessing at the end. Come on, saints. Jacob would not let God go until he blessed him. How do you know God is not disappointed with our lack?
Wait. I'm out of here, y'all. I can't take this. That hit me. That hit me. How do you know God is not disappointed with the lack of interest the church has for the Holy Ghost? The lack of zeal, the lack of hunger and thirst. Jesus said in his word, blessed are you that hunger and thirst, you shall be filled. Maybe the reason you haven't been filled yet and you don't understand my testimony is because you're not having enough hunger and thirst. I'm not trying to brag and act like I'm better than you because I was filled with the Holy Ghost and fire. But I'm not going to tolerate jealous, wicked people out there that want to accuse me of that because they're jealous that they didn't do. You don't know what I went through to be filled with the Holy Ghost and fire. You don't know my wife and I's sacrifice. When my wife was baptized in the tub, I baptized her. That night she was baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. But if you don't know the supernatural, if I tell you we've seen angels and you get a wicked, unclean devil online telling you, oh, I'm some kind of warlock because I talk about angels visiting us. What kind of wicked, dark mind is that? What Bible is he reading? Angels are all through this book. I'm not going to back away from telling the truth because of slanderers. But will you believe? Belief. Remember the Bible says the fearful and the unbelieving are the first two people categories cast into the lake of fire. It's disgusting to God. Be careful when men and women of God tell you supernatural testimonies that you do not mock it. And if you get tempted, just walk away. It's better you walk away than mock something holy. Saints of God, are you ready to pray with me? Are you ready to desire to be filled with the Holy Ghost and fire? Your life will never be the same. Match my testimony with my fruit. Do you want to know why God gives me so many amazing revelations? Do you want to know why we can step into a room of 300 people and by the sound of Jesus Christ in my voice, demons come out of hundreds of people? Is it because of me? No! It's because years ago, when you didn't know who I was crying in my prayer closet. I was weeping. I was praying. I was fasting. I was fighting everything I had in me to stay away from sin. I didn't want to pervert and corrupt my body and pollute my body and have the Holy Spirit not want to fill in me. I desired the Holy Ghost more than life itself. I was still living in my mother's house before I even got blessed with my wife and children. And I showed God that I desired His Holy Spirit. Have you done that? If you haven't, who are you to judge me? Who are you to mock my testimony? Or who are you to be jealous and try to accuse me of making myself better than you because I've been filled? These wicked liars, they're not leaders. They're lying to you. Witchcraft workers try to tell you, oh, they just say that so you feel underneath them. What are you talking about? We're not all on the same level. Get over it. Don't you know that's that sodomite stuff? That Ahabic Jezebel kingdom? We're all the same. No, we're not. There's somebody on this planet greater than me. Oh, well, I'm over it. Whatever. There's someone taller than me. Big deal. There's someone that has raised more dead people than I will. Okay. Am I going to get jealous? No. Maybe that man or that woman has more passion for God than me. I'm bold right now, saints. You can't tell this is a godly boldness? You got to get rid of those people out of your life. Not condemn, but get them out of your life for a season. Get cleared up. Have a clean mind.
Stop always thinking negative. Stop always accusing people. Hopeful. Be hopeful. Think on these things, the Bible says. So all I can do is tell you it's real. All I can tell you is it happened to me. My wife had her experience. That elder had his experience. Will you have yours? And maybe you have. Maybe you're like, man of God, that's what happened to me. I heard this wind. It was like a window opened up or a portal. Maybe you like the word I use. Stephen Darby used it. Right? Maybe this window opened up. Maybe you got the same testimony as us. I say amen. But seek the Holy Ghost. We need the Holy Ghost, y'all. We are not winning a supernatural war in this last days against the Nephilim, the Illuminati, the Luciferians without the Holy Ghost. And he's on the back burner of your life. It's time to pray. I can feel it. It's time to pray. And I'm going to pray, and I want to actually integrate this into the prayer. Say this with me. Say, Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, forgive me of all sins known and unknown. Wash me in your holy blood. Mind, body, soul, spirit. I forgive all my enemies. I renounce and reject all powers of darkness, all forces of evil, all of the occult, all of witchcraft, anything I've been involved with or my father and mother in the bloodline behind them. In the name of Jesus Christ, say, Lord, forgive me for not seeking for the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire the way I should. Say, Lord, fill me with a hunger and thirst for the Holy Ghost and fire. Not so I can get power hungry, because it's not by thy power nor by thy might, but by thy spirit, says the Lord. But simply, Lord, that I need you to be filled in me to make it in this last hour. Lord Jesus Christ, thank you for giving me wisdom on gateways, doors, windows, or portals. Openings, Lord, where you send angels to ascend and descend. Lord, make me. Open up a window over me. Open up a doorway, a gateway over my life, God. And ascend and descend. Have angels minister to me, Lord Jesus, your holy angels, not fallen angels, your holy angels, Lord Jesus. Father God, I ask you, Jesus, to draw me to you, Lord God. Protect me. Say, Lord, protect me, Jesus. I don't want to be filled with wrath, madness, sorrow, confusion, envy, indignation. Come on, saints. I reject all of those things in Jesus Christ's name. You are not allowed to fill me, Satan. Get away from me in Jesus' mighty name. I rebuke you. Now say, Lord Jesus, fill me with the fear of God. Yes, there it is. Say, Lord Jesus, fill me with joy. Lord Jesus, fill me with wonder and amazement. Lord Jesus, fill me with gladness. Say, Lord Jesus, fill me with the fruits of righteousness. Say, Lord Jesus, fill me with the knowledge of your will and all wisdom and understanding. Lord, do it at your time as I obey you. Because you said, Lord Jesus Christ, you give the Holy Ghost to them that obey you. Wow, that's amazing. You would bubble that scripture, Lord. Say, Lord Jesus Christ, I want my cup to run over, just like David spoke. I want to be pressed down and shaken good measure, that my cup runneth over to others, Lord Jesus. Say, Lord Jesus Christ, breathe on me, and I want to receive the Holy Spirit right now, and just simply believe that Jesus is breathing on you right now, saints. It has to be a supernatural faith thing. Inhale and receive you, the Holy Spirit. Isn't that amazing? I'm not talking about when these foolish people blow into the microphone. Receive the Holy Spirit. Who are they? Who are they? That's Jesus that does that. And if he does it through a person, that's one thing. But just receive the Holy Spirit by faith. Say, I receive you, Holy Spirit, right now by faith,
through grace by the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Say that. In the name of Jesus Christ. Say, now, Lord, I want to be in one accord with the church. I want to go to my upper room, that spiritual upper room. And Lord, I want you to baptize me in the Holy Ghost and fire. I want that doorway to open up over me. I want you to come through and fill me and lay hands on me, O great high priest, and fill me with the Holy Ghost and fire. I want to hear that mighty rushing wind. Wow. Wow. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And I ask you to open up spiritual doors in my life. Doors of faith. Yes, what a great prayer. Lord, open up doors of faith in my life. Open up doors of utterance for the word of the Lord in my life. Open up whatever doors you see fit, Jesus. Open these supernatural doors over my life. And shut any unclean doors in my life. Shut any unclean portals, any unclean gateways. Shut them. I shut them in Jesus' mighty name. And I ask you to open and keep open your holy doors, your holy portals, your holy gateways. Open them up and keep them open over my life. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I pray. Amen. Tell me that was not amazing. Oh, that was phenomenal. You know, I was going to show y'all the video that man made, and I'm not going to. It's not worthy to be on with this message. You pray that man does that. You pray he repents. I'm telling you, it's very bad what he did. Very evil. Very evil. And let that be a lesson learned for everybody, including myself. Be slow to speak, quick to listen, and just because something seems strange, I gotta sit down. Just because something seems strange or foreign doesn't make it wrong. Just because you haven't experienced something doesn't mean it's not real, okay? I'm telling you guys, I'm telling you, angels are real. The power of God is real. The Holy Spirit is real. Jesus Christ is real. His kingdom is real. But know that there are evil angels. There's an evil devil. There's an evil kingdom. And there's a war right now for you. Who's going to fill in you? You decide. As far as me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord and get used to pour out onto you. What do you think happens every time? So many of you have wrote us in and sent us testimonies about how God has changed your life through this ministry. You want to know what it really is? Every single time you tune in faithfully to watch a video, and I'm not going to splash the table again, but I'm splashing you with the word of the Lord supernaturally by the sound of Christ in my voice. When you listen, when you see the visuals, all of that, you're receiving the word of God, even supernaturally. How awesome is that? How amazing is that? So thank you for being by our side. And please pray for us. You know, this, all this attacks going on and the slander, it's very vexing because we got so much stuff we have to get done. There's so many mess. I'm behind. I got to get the mystery of the ark done, the right hand of power done, the lingering wounds of Eve, an amazing message. Ladies, you better look out for that one. But, you know, I had to do the things I had to do. But this right here, I am so grateful for. Oh, what the enemy meant for evil, God truly turned for good. Because the prayer you just did, I'm telling you, it's supernatural. You be on the lookout for change in your life. All glory to Jesus Christ. So I'm done, y'all. Thank you for enduring with me, long-suffering, sticking with me through the end to this message. Love you so much. And remember, don't forget, if you haven't spoken tongues, it doesn't mean you don't have the Holy Spirit, okay? But if you have the Holy Spirit, it doesn't mean you just stay, content with just a little bit of the presence of God in you. No, you have to be hungry to be filled with God, okay? Because it's disrespectful. Remember, Jesus filled the seven water pots. He filled them to the brim. You should desire to be filled to the brim. Remember Jesus at the wedding, remember when he turned the water into wine? He filled each pot to the brim. That represents us. We need to be filled to the brim. And then we, wow, I thought I was done, y'all, in Jesus' name. I thought I was done. I just caught a revelation. It's only until you get filled to the brim do you transform into something else. Remember, he said you can't put new wine into old wineskins, into old bottles, right? You can't put new wine into old wineskins or old wine bottles. It'll burst. You have to change. Your life has to change. You have to become a new creature to get filled with the new wine, to get filled with the Holy Ghost. Wow. Remember the 12 baskets? They were filled with the leftovers. There's this filling mystery. It's just amazing. So I hope you really were blessed by this. I think it's safe to say at least this is part one. You know what I mean? To kind of give you peace, to know if you believe in Jesus Christ, if you've accepted him as your Lord in truth, if you've been washed by the blood of the Lamb and you're striving to live for the Lord, the Holy Spirit is in you without a shadow of a doubt. If what I've described you're doing, you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. If you've accepted him into you, the Holy Spirit of Christ has entered into you. But you got to get baptized in water in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth into the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And then go into the upper room. Be in one accord with the believers around you. Avoid slander. Avoid foolishness. Don't get involved with mockery stuff. Be careful. Seek the Lord together so we can get this mighty rushing wind. Amen. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ. Love y'all. Bless.
One day, this portal opens up over you while you're on your knees or on your face, and you hear this wind. Wham! You get hit with this power you've never experienced. If you're not sure of it, it didn't happen. That doesn't mean God didn't visit you, he didn't touch you. But I'm telling you, you cannot mistake the baptism of the Holy Ghost in fire. This power will go through your back, fill into your belly. And you can literally hear a rushing wind. Other people won't hear it. Or they might. But it was at that moment you were completed as a tabernacle.
Reports of community drug use, they decided to add a special Sunday afternoon youth service. Among those leading the meeting were Pastor Moses Kayak and his ministerial colleagues Joshua and James Ariak, all great-grandsons of the original lightkeeper, Onguetizawak.
An invitation was offered for youth who felt they wanted to come closer to God.
Worship leader Louis Ariak was praying over the youth that had gathered around the altar.
I felt so close to God, and he kept giving me this verse that says, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God."
Something started to happen that was out of our control.
This noise started coming.
Yeah, it started softly, like you can barely hear it.
A dual cassette deck used to record the service was still running off the soundboard.
Right away, I wanted to stop.
But it kept getting louder, and I started to notice that people were kind of getting a little nervous.
It was so strong, so strong.
It was so loud that everything started to shake.
Fire went right through me.
It sounded like a jet.
Things start to shake. I started to shake.
I told myself, there's no jets in Pond Inlet.
After this extraordinary visitation, it was evident the moment still had power.
Every time I thought about it, I was greatly humbled. Thinking that the Almighty God can visit us.
When Pastor Moses Kayak first heard the low-pitched rumbling, he walked over to the church soundboard to adjust the settings.
I tried this, not stop, tried this, no stop.
When these efforts failed to correct the situation, he quickly turned down the master control. When this too failed, he shut the system off completely. Still, the sound and the recording continued.
It shouldn't have been recorded. It's only by the miracle of God.
He was completely humbled to the point where he wanted to continually come before God, kneel, and ask for prayer, and ask for the cleansing of the heart to become pure before him.